Battle through thick and thin. Shot boss, get it ready, let the beast come in. Check out the sounds coming out for human job box. Get a teeth to make the body jump and rock. If you like what you hear, all fresh and new. Quiet people, here's a solo from Jock to you.
I'm fresh.
You gotta
be fresh.
Oh, three of us all. Well, I
fresh.
Skinny boys in the place to be. Super J, the skinny
boys are fresh.
Try to see MLS if you know what I mean. The skinny boys came here to make that grease. We bust through the door without a knock. Shot and short. Super J, kick it. That was the fucking great, and he kept it straight for all the five pieces. Kick it, just hit this. Pull up, pull out the pocket. Dump it in a slot. Dog the beat, cause you're the human jackpot. Try to try to imitate.
I'm so
straight, and the beat makes every single break.
I'm angry at 31. You angry at 15.
Years ago, I interviewed Kwesi Nfume, then the president of the NAACP. As between the presence of white racism and the absence of black fathers, I asked him, which poses the bigger threat to the black community? Without missing a beat, he said, the absence of black fathers. It was President Barack Obama who said, we all know these statistics, that children who grow up without a father are 5 times more likely to live in poverty and commit crime, 9 times more likely to drop out of school, and 20 times more likely to end up in prison. The Journal of Research on Adolescence confirms during low household income, kids in father-absent homes are more likely to end up in
complicated. Because I grab the mic and try to say yes, y'all. They try to take it and say that I'm too small. Cool. Because I don't get upset. I kick a hole in the speaker, pull a plug, then I jet. And I back to the lab without a mic to grab. So then I add all the rhymes I had, one after the other one. Then I make another one to diss the opposite than ask if the brother's done. I get it craving like I feel for nicotine, but I don't need a cigarette. Know what I mean? Creeping up the stages, don't it sound amazing? Cause every rhyme is made in order, cause it's sort of an addiction, magnetized by the mixing, focus vocabulary, which is stuck in. The mic is a drain, volcanoes erupting, rhymes overflowing, gradually growing, everything is written
The nation's poverty rate was 34%. By 1965, it was cut in half to 17%, all before President Lyndon Johnson's so-called war on poverty. But after that war began in 1965, poverty began to flatline. From 1965 until now, the government has spent over $20 trillion to fight poverty. The poverty rate has remained unchanged, but the relationship between poor men and women has changed dramatically. That's because our generous welfare system allows women, in effect, to marry the government. And this makes it all too easy for men to abandon their traditional moral and financial responsibilities. Psychologists call such dependency learned selfishness. How do we know that the welfare state creates This incentive desperate to bury people were trying to help. They helped. In 1985, the Los Angeles Times asked both the poor and the non-poor whether poor women often have children to get additional benefits. Most of the non-poor respondents said no. However, 54% of poor respondents said yes. Now, who do you think is in a better position to know? Tupac Shakur, the late rapper, once said, "I know for a fact that had I had a father, I had some discipline, I'd have more confidence." He admitted he began running with gangs because he wanted the things a father gives to a child, especially to a boy: structure and protection. Father cannot calm you down the way a man can, Shakur said. You need a man to teach you how to be a man. Dear father, this time, I write about the rough, tough World War II Marine Staff Sergeant Dan. Born in the Jim Crow of Athens, Georgia, he was 14 at the start of the Great Depression. Growing up, I watched my father work two full-time jobs as a janitor, also cook for a rich family on the weekends, and somehow managed to go to night school to get his GED. When I was 10, my father opened a small restaurant that he ran until he retired mid-80s. Never angry or insisted that today's America was very different from the world of racial segregation and limited opportunity in which he grew up. Hard work wins, he told me and my brothers. You get out of life what you put into it. You can't control the outcome, but you are 100% in control of the outcome. And before blaming other people, go to the nearest mirror and ask yourself, what could I have done to change the outcome? This advice shaped my life. Fathers matter. Until we have a government policy that makes that its first priority, nothing will change. I'm Larry Elder from Craig University. You can't stand where I stand, you can't walk where I walk. Watch out! Policeman come with foot off the clock. I know this for a fact. You don't like how I act. You claim I'm selling crack. Will you be doing that? I'd rather say see ya, cause I would never be ya. Be your officer, your wicked overseer. Your hot shot, you wanna get cops and be a savior. First show a little respect, change your behavior. Change your attitude, change your plan. There could never really be justice or stolen land. Are you really for peace and equality? Or with my car hooked up, you know you wanna to minimal. Cause you think about looking at the criminal. This has got to cease. Now we be getting hyped to the sound of the police.
Your attention's undivided. Many in the past have tried to do what I did, but just the way I came off then, I'm gonna come off stronger and longer, even with the trouble. I keep on going and flowing just like a river. I got a whole lot to give, so I'm a giver. Little at a time, new trails are blazing. Action is in effect, it always stays in. Yeah, just like a shot from a cannon. I am the man in charge and I've been planning. Jam strong enough that it can lift your soul. I'm the originator, and my rhymes are made of gold. Once you hear the capital A, rap it'll stay and hang you for a while. It won't go away unless you force it. You force it away, I'ma hit you again. I project my voice so it's right in the crowd. There's a sign that white and loud. And if you didn't read it, I suggest you do so, or you'll be stranded just like a Russo. Sleep if you shut up, man, broke his jaw trying to say what I say on the microphone. He should have left it alone just for the record. Know that my ego's only partially grown. And never would I ever condone. Write it in any form, you are only warm. That verse was the calm, now here's the storm. I believe that's me. Craig G, light up the mic for the symphony. The gym is dedicated to all unoptimistic. I thought I wasn't coming out with some exquisite rhymes. That's alright, cause now I'm back to kill all the rumors and straighten the facts for me. Now rock your rhymes like I always used to, but you jumped on the tip when you heard me in the juice cruise. You said, ain't that something? No, Craig, I heard you in that jam, it's something. I apologize. Can I have your autograph for me and my grandma? Because I'm living on surprise mode. Don't even sleep. Try not to keep your eyes closed. Because if you do, when you awaken, the cold spot will be taken. I'll take it over like a greedy executive. My perspective is to be the best in all rap events. And since I have a call, I call it experience.
Nah, next up!
Yo, I believe that's me. Gucci, watch my other mic for the symphony. Yo, that's
nice,
kid. Nice,
my
voice
twice
as hard to find. That's actually great. Nice, go see. Till you fell in a spell of sleep. And while I'm counting the money, you count sheep. You rap twice the mic. I recite the type, the hype that you like to make the people unite. I'm a magnificent spotlight. Step on raps. Flip, I want to slip on my tip. Take a deep breath because you don't have enough left. Coming back like I'm avenging my brother's death. Make your veterans run for medicine. Because I put out more light than a fight to con Edison. Rip the damn cage. If you want rage, I'ma make front page. The headline, suckers, the day's the deadline. The head is way past bedtime. Can't kill the show, cause I'm still on. Sounds like a pillow. So fear me, don't dare dare me, don't compare me to him when you hear me. Talk about a battle, but you ain't yet ready for war. Your metaphor sucks more than a whore. Damn, replace me, ice me or ace me. Lace me, face me, slice me or race me. Spike me or taste me, clear that I got force. My rap burns your mouth like hot sauce. Run for water while I break to take the corner. Turn to sucker, the order is manslaughter. Another rapper, G-Rap Rex, he's waiting next. For your sex, the next, but amplify gets used and abused. Once so loud, we might blow. This is anger, it's ready to hang up. I'm a finger, I'm putting up a middle finger.
Next
I believe that's me. Daddy can't get on a mic for the symphony. Caution, I'm not forcing around in a throwdown clown. I'm taking your side, so just acknowledge the kick because of rap was a hot. That is hard.
Yes! Have you ever now it's know where the fellas on the mic with one minute rhymes so that don't
I've come out mostly right been called coming out the left right on my show because I consider myself part of the left, and I've seen the left sort of really go off the deep end to the left, and I haven't been happy about it. So I haven't talked that much about the right. I've had a couple people on the right. So first off, how would
Testing, testing. What's going on? Can people hear me? All right. All right, and there's the DJ coming in. Yeah. All right, that's what we're doing. All right, I hope everybody's...
Hey, yo, be a father. Yeah, if not, why bother, son? A boy can make him, but a man can... Right, you didn't admit it, just quit it. Don't say it ain't yours.
All
women, I'm not saying... A woman that is faithful. Ladies, can I hear it? When a girl gets pregnant, her man is gonna run around. Dissing her for 9 months when it's born, he wants to come around. Talking at him, sorry for what he did. And all of a sudden, he now wants to see his kid. She had to bury by herself and take care of it by herself. And giving her some money for milk won't really help. Half of the fathers with sons and daughters don't even want to take them. But it's so easy for them to make it true. If it weren't for you, exist. After a skis, there's responsibility. So don't resist, be a father to your child. 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 You see, hey, yo, be a father. If not, why bother? Make him but a man. Did it admit? Don't say it ain't yours. Cause all women are not fours. 90% represent a woman that is faithful. Ladies, can I hear it? When a girl gets pregnant, her man is gonna run around. Dissing her for 9 months when it's born. He wants to come around. Talking at him, sorry for I did. And all of a sudden, he want to see his kid. She gets buried by herself and up and tearing herself. And giving her some money for milk won't really help. Half of the fathers with sons and daughters don't even want to take them. But it's so easy for them to make them. It's true. If it weren't for you, then the child wouldn't exist. After a skis, there's responsibility. Don't resist. Be a father to your child. 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 You see, I hate when a brother makes a child and then denies it, thinking that a lot of presents.
Testing, 1, 2, 1, 2.
That you couldn't do. You're claiming you was there, but not when she needed you. And now you wanna come around for a day or two. It's never too late to correct your mistakes. So get yourself together for your child's sake and be a father to your child.
Okay.
Let's go. Hey, what's up, family? Thank you all for joining us today. This is your man, Dr. Lamar Darnell Shields, in the building. And if you know, we have tech issues. That's just the reality of the world that we're in. But we want to thank you all for joining us today. We have a powerful packed show for you all. Let's give it up for DJ Leroy. DJ Leroy cutting on the ones and twos. He mixed a little old school. He mixed a little new school. He hit one of my songs from the late 90s, Be a Father to Your Child. But it's not about me. It's not about the DJ. It's about the host, and it's about these amazing fathers. Today's show is about breaking the myths about Black fatherhood on this Black Father's Day. As you can see, I'm rocking my Black Father shirt. The inaccurate perceptions that African-American families are devastated by the absent fathers that need to return to their responsibilities informs policies, law formulation, and a variety of harmful ways. See, this viewpoint about Black fatherhood is well-established structure of thought with a host of supporting beliefs that reinforce it like rebar in a concrete slab. Society is devastated because the majority of African-American fathers are not in their home, and we know that is not true. The solution, therefore, is to bring Black men to step up to their responsibilities. But as a researcher and as a producer of this show, Dr. Lamar Darnell Shields, I'm always following the research. And despite what the media is saying, data from the Center for Disease Control and Prevention reports that says that Black fathers are in the homes. And furthermore, whether living in the same home or not, Black fathers are the most involved. I want you all to hear this. Black fathers are the most involved of all the primary recorded race of all ethnic groups. So right now, let's give it up for the Black and brown fathers that are out there that are doing this much needed work. Next up, I want to bring up my partner from the Black Fathers Foundation. We are donating a lot of the proceeds from today's show. You might have seen his brother on the Steve Harvey Show. He hangs out with Mark Zuckerberg. He's been all over celebrating Black fathers. Who am I talking about? Let's put your hands together for Matt Pressberry.
Peace, good peoples. I'm happy to be here tonight. Thank you, brother, for bringing me on. And thank you for allowing the foundation to be a part of this, and especially to benefit from the donations. For those who don't know me, I'm Matt Pressberry. I'm the founder of the Facebook group Black Fathers, circa 2008. We're coming into our 12th anniversary coming up in December. We have over 71,000 members on six continents around the world. And in 2019, my wife and I created the Black Fathers Foundation, which we've been talking about. And the purpose of the foundation is really to be an extension in a physical form of what we had, or what we still have, I shouldn't say had, what we still have in the Black Fathers group on Facebook. So Lamar talked about being a researcher and studies, but, and you know, we've seen the studies and all of that, which is fantastic, but I never needed a study because I got 71,000 plus guys in this group who share the stereotypes and murder myths every day about who we are as Black men raising our children. So I'm here to tell y'all, you can believe whatever you want, but every day in my work, and along with my wife, we work to really create pathways through which Black men can tell their own stories. And that's really what the foundation is about. In addition to being a funding organization, we're providing micro grants, scholarships, and emergency funds for fathers in need. We've already been in the process of doing that. And also partnerships and networking, of course, which we have an example of tonight with this presentation. So I don't want to keep you all long. I do want to say really quickly, please join us Monday night. We have the second edition of our Frontline Fathers panel discussion, talking to fathers who are really on the front lines in the fight against COVID and also the fight against social and racial injustices happening across the country and beyond. So that's 6 p.m. Monday night on the Black Fathers Foundation page. We're also going through StreamYard. So it'll stream on the Black Fathers Foundation page. And if you are a member of the Black Fathers group, you can also see it there and on our Twitter, the Black Fathers Foundation. So again, Monday night, please check us out. Also follow us on Twitter and IG, the Black Fathers Foundation. And I think that's all I got. And again, I want to welcome you all. I really hope you enjoy the show. I think you will. We actually, my wife and I have two IG shows, one on Wednesday at 1 and one on Fridays at 5. And on one of them, we welcomed Lamar Shields and two cast members of this show. So I'm really excited about what you're going to see. And I don't want to keep you from it. So I'm going to say goodbye and I'm going to enjoy the show along with you. Peace.
Brother, man, I love you. I appreciate you for everything that you've done for Black fathers across the country. Before I begin, I need to thank my children for making me a father. I need to thank Hadiah Ayodele Shields. I need to thank Samira Adama Nafia Shields and Mosiah Sekou Shields for making me a father. And it's always what we do. If you've never been to a Shortcut show, this is an award-winning show featured all over the country. This is our second virtual show, but we always pay homage to our ancestors, our creator, whatever you call our creator. But we know the African concept means is when you call somebody's name, they are always here. So in order to start this show, we like to pour libation. And for those that are very familiar with libation, we take the water, the substance, and we pour it into a plant. And what we do is we say Ashe. Ashe means amen. Ashe means so be it. Ashe means you on the right path. Ashe means that we are celebrating those individuals. And so I want to start out first honoring the fathers of some of the cast members as well as some of our production team members. But I want to start and pour libation for my father, John Henry Shields. And we say, Ashe. We pour libation for Leon Steve. We say, Ashe. We pour libation for Robert Wilmore. And we say, Ashe. We pour libation for Anthony Payne Sr. And we say, Ashe. We pour libation for Charlie Brooks. And we say, Ashe. We pour libation for Paul Allen. We say Ashe. We pour libation for Willie B. Lewis. And we say Ashe. We pour libation for Leon Steele. And we say Ashe. We pour libation for Joseph S. Eubanks. And we say Ashe. We pour libation for Walter Banks. And we say Ashe. We pour libation for Norman Neal. And we say Ashe. And we want you out there in the virtual space. If your dad or your bonus dad transitioned, we call their names. And we say, call their names out. Call their names out. Call their names out, and we say, Ashe, Ashe, Ashe. Now we pour libation for those heroes, those Black men, those Black fathers who transitioned, who were fathers. We know that many of them were civil rights activists. We know many of them were actors, and we know that many of them were fought on the front lines. I want to pour libation for my mentor, Congressman Elijah Cummings, and we say, Ashe. I want to pour libation for another congressman that I got a chance to meet who just transitioned from Georgia. We pour libation for Congressman John Lewis. We say Ashe. We pour libation for one of my great mentors, Elhaj Malik Shabazz. People know him as Malcolm X. And we say Ashe. We pour libation for Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. We say Ashe. We pour libation for the great actor Ozzie Davis. And we say Ashe. We pour libation for the great brother from Southeast DC. His name is Marvin Gaye. We say Ashe. We pour libation for the great soul singer, unlike anybody else, Howard University's own, straight out of Chicago, out of St. Louis. His name is Donnie Hathaway. We say Ashe. We pour libation for the man that we named our school after, the great leader, thespian, and educator. His name is Paul Robeson. We say Ashe. And we pour libation, finally, for the man who would knock you out not only with his fists, but would knock you out with his words. But he has some amazing daughters and some amazing sons. Many of you all knew him as Cassius Clay, but we know him as Muhammad Ali. We say Ashe. And for all the fathers that we might have missed out there, we say Ashe, Ashe, Ashe. For all the fathers that have transitioned, we say Ashe, Ashe, Ashe. And so it is, B. So it is. And so now we're going to get this party started. And what are we going to do? We have a great host that has been rocking this show for a very long time. I love this brother. He is not only an educator, a community activist. He is a brother who is responsible and taking care of his own children. The brother grew up in Virginia by way of Kenya. You might have seen this man on tons of TV shows. If not, you might have caught him at Douglas High School because he's a teacher and he's also a comedy coach. You might know him. His name is Karagu, the host of our show. Put your hands together for the host of this amazing show. Put your hands together for my brother Karagu in the building.
Hello, hello, hello. Can y'all hear me? We're good? Finally. Yes.
Prepared. Troops refuse to fight.
Yes.
I want my they would rather switch.
All right, this is a little problematic. That part where he's talking about they would rather switch. Y'all, I am very happy to be here and finally get started. I'm extremely annoyed. My kids are not in the house, so I was thinking I would have some time to myself. And I've been on this call all day long talking to people, producers for this show and somebody else from the show, and then somebody else had feelings and all. This is supposed to be my time, all right? And I ain't getting it right now. But I care this much about this issue, all right? Black fathers are underrepresented class. No one talks about us. All right, and I don't want to make this sound like some type of men's right thing where I'm just like, yeah, it's like all about the guys. All right, that's not it. A lot of comedians, they talk about like their problems. They talk about, I'm depressed, I'm fat. I'm fine. All right, I'm fine. I have a job that's paying me during the quarantine. I got a loving wife that cares about me and kids with good grades. As a matter of fact, they call me like the Cosby in my block. It used to be a compliment. Now no one to drink with me. Who am I kidding? No one to drink with anybody now because of this corona right here. I left the house yesterday. I feel like every time I leave the house, I got it. You ever do that? Like for about 24 hours, I'm infected. I lay down and I feel my feelings. I get the vapors. I think that's what this is. But this right here, we put all this work into the show and had all of these meetings working with people who are not professional speakers, all right, to share their stories with you. All right, so we really appreciate all of your time. Y'all being here is the reason why I'm sitting here sweating right now and not off drinking and enjoying myself like I should be. All right, so I'll ask that all of you sit back and enjoy yourself. Please, we have fathers of all walks of life, all right? All walks of life is everybody with different experiences, and I really look forward to getting this started. So, DJ? Y'all, get it started. Let's get it started. All right. Want to go ahead. Our first speaker coming up. I want to make sure everybody's good to go. Y'all good? All right. Our first speaker coming to you is going to share a story that is much different than my own. And I think you're going to really enjoy it. Y'all, please give it up for Mr. Anthony Outler.
I ain't no perfect man. I'm trying to do the best that I can with what it is I have. I ain't no perfect man. I'm trying.
So it was the spring of 2007. I just gotten home, sitting on my couch after a long day of teaching seventh grade world history. And about 20 minutes passed by, my wife, she comes home. And I noticed when she comes home, in addition to her work things in her hands, she also had a gift bag. And she put her work things down, came over to me and presented the gift bag to me. And I was sat there and I was thinking to myself, hey, nice. You know, it wasn't my birthday, any other kind of special occasion. Hey, it's always a good day to get a gift. So anyway, I take the gift bag, reach my hand into the bag and realize that there's a book inside. Now, mind you, I'm in grad school at the time. And so I got, you know, books everywhere, actually, you know, and I figured that maybe she had gotten me another book that I needed for class. So anyway, I pull the book out, look at the title, and the title of the book is The Expectant Father, The Ultimate Guide for Fathers to Be. And so in that moment, I'm like, why is she giving me this book? Right. You know, I appreciate it, but I got this mound of books that I have to read. But hey, you know, I guess I'll get to this one at some point. But in the next moment, she reaches in her purse and she pulls out a pregnancy test and shows me the positive sign. Bam. We were about to be parents. She was pregnant. And guys, I tell you, in that moment, I experienced the full range, every emotion that you can experience, I experienced in that moment. At that once, I was stunned, happy, scared, surprised, excited, all at the same time. And I remember my wife and I jumping around the living room, right? We were, you know, we had a moment of just celebration. But later on that night, I remember sitting down and I really began to think, you know, real hard. I began to reflect on all the responsibilities that come along with fatherhood. Not only that, I began to think really, really deeply about the implications of my fatherhood, the fact that I was about to become the father of a biracial child. Yes, as you can see, I'm a black man born and raised in the great city of Atlanta, Georgia. And my wife is Persian. She's Iranian. She was born in Tehran, Iran. So as you might imagine, that night I'm sitting there, I'm having all kinds of thoughts. You know, what's the baby going to look like? Is it going to be a boy or a girl? Right. So I'm having all these thoughts. But the thought that was prevalent in my mind and the thing I thought about most was the implications. Right. What it was going to take to raise a child, a biracial child, to navigate this society that we live in. And that was the scariest part for me as it relates to becoming a father. And so anyway, because you think about it, you know, as I thought about it, all the story, a lot of the stories that I had heard about biracial kids, about kids growing up biracial, weren't particularly encouraging. You know, I think about one of my friends, he and I had a conversation. He's biracial, half black, half white. And I remember him talking to me about his growing up experience. He talked to me about the fact that as he was growing up, he was never really, secure in his skin. He said he grew up depressed, right? He said that he really, you know, didn't like the fact that he was black. He said, you know, he was embarrassed to be black. You know, he said he didn't fit in with the black people, fit in with the white people. It was very difficult for him growing up in his biracial body. And as he was talking to me about this, I remember I could hear his voice quivering and I could see the pain in his eyes. And I was like, man, you know, first of all, I wasn't aware that he had this experience. Second of all, you know, I just couldn't imagine, you know, growing up like this. And I knew that I didn't want my kids to have this experience. I knew I didn't want my kids to grow up confused or conflicted about any part of their identity. So again, this was the scariest part of becoming a father. In that same moment, I began to also think back to conversations that my wife and I had had while we were dating. And, you know, as we got closer to, you know, discussing marriage and that possibility, we had conversations about kids. And I remember that first conversation that we had as we sat down and my wife, she sat down, she looked me square in my eyes. And she said, you know what, babe, if we ever have kids, you know, they're going to be viewed as black in this society. So we're going to have to educate them and teach them to be able to live and navigate this society as black people. And let me tell you this, I was absolutely, I said, wow, she gets it, right? Here this is woman from the Middle East, other side of the world, you know, with this understanding as it relates to the racial dynamics in this country and the implications that that has for a biracial kid. So at once that was very comforting for me. It was also a confirmation that not only, you know, we were in love and all these things, and I know we had a spiritual connection and such, but at the same time, I knew that it was important, in addition to all of that, that we had a shared racial and social consciousness, because that was extremely important, particularly if we were to build a strong, unified, culturally conscious, culturally competent interracial family. That was essential. So fast forward. January 22nd, 2008, my first son is born. We named him Justice Amin. We were very intentional about his name. We wanted his name to have meaning. We wanted the name that we gave him to draw out those attributes that we wanted him to exhibit to the world. And so when he was born, guys, I remember I immediately started to work, right? In addition to loving on him, hugging him, kissing him as much as humanly possible, I remember also just from an early age wanting to expose him to as many positive images of blackness as I could. So we read a whole bunch of books with a whole bunch of black and brown folks in them. I remember as a little baby, I would put him on my lap and there was this book that we would read, that one of our favorites called Jazz Baby. And the book had like these rhymes and rhythms in it, right? And so one of the lines I remember, it was like, brother's hands tap, sister's hands snap, itty bitty baby's hands clap, clap, clap. And he would be in my lap. And on that part, I would take his little hands and clap them together. And he would smile and giggle and those types of things. Not only that, I was very mindful and conscious of the things that he was consuming, the images he was consuming on TV. As he became around the age of 5 or 6, I would notice that as my wife and I were watching the news, I would see his eyes kind of honing in on the screen, right? And these news reports, you know, of black men being arrested and all other types of dysfunctionalities in our community. And I didn't want him exposed to those images of blackness before he was at an age where I could explain to him about systemic racism and how that works, about, you know, the prison industrial complex. I just didn't want him exposed to those images. Not only that, I found myself, because of where we live, I found myself driving further out to ensure that he could go to rec centers with a number of black boys and play basketball and be on those teams to be able to have those positive interactions and develop those positive relationships with other black boys. And I tell you guys, as far as I was concerned, you know, we were on the right path, right? I could tell by his conversations, I could tell by his relationships, his friendships, all of these things that we were on the right track. You know, my son was solid and he was, you know, secure in himself. Until about 3 years ago, he was about 9 years old. I remember I was sitting at home and he and my wife had been out that day and they came home and, you know, I greeted them. Hey, how you doing? How was your day? And my wife, she said, hey, babe, remind me later on, I need to talk to you about something. And the way she said it, you know, I knew she probably wanted to talk to me about my son, Justice. So anyway, later on that night, we're sitting down and she says, hey, babe, here's what I want to talk to you about. She said, I've noticed on a couple of occasions we've been out and when we pass by a group of black men or black boys that are dressed in certain ways, twisted hair, sagging pins and such. She said, I noticed like Justice appearing like looking at them, right? As if he's concerned or nervous or that kind of thing. And she said the first time that it happened, you know, she checked her own energy, right? She said she needed to make sure that there was nothing that she was, you know, energy she was emitting that was making him react in a certain type of way. But she said the second time she saw him doing it this particular time, and she asked him, she said, hey, you know, why are you looking at them like that? Why were you looking at them like that? And his response was, oh, you know, as if he was caught off guard, like he didn't really know that he was looking. So I'm listening to all this and, you know, I'm thinking to myself, like, man, where in the world is this coming from? And truthfully, you know, it began to like trouble me. Right. I'm like, you know, I've been doing all the things, you know what I mean? And, you know, it seems like he should be solid. What's happening here? And, you know, truthfully, guys, in that moment, you know, my first inclination was to run up in his room, go to this bookshelf back here, pull out my Wretched of the Earth, hit him over the head with The Miseducation of the Negro, Autobiography of Malcolm X. I was about to give him a crash course in Black Liberation 101. But in that moment, it dawned on me, it said, hey, brother, chill out, relax. And instead of confronting him and talking to him about it, I instead sat down and I reflected. And I began to reflect on the fact that, you know, we were doing everything that, you know, we should have been doing, right? I began to reflect on the fact that, man, there's no way, you know, with the pervasiveness of these narratives in our society, there's no way that I would 100% be able to shield him from these narratives, no matter what I did. As a matter of fact, it dawned on me that I can't 100% shield myself from them. We're all impacted by these narratives in certain types of ways. So it reminded me that I have to remain vigilant. I have to stay the course. I was on the right track. We were doing the right thing. There was nothing wrong with my son, is what I had to realize. What there was something wrong with is the society that we live in. There's something wrong with the ideological apparatus that spreads this information, that propagates information, stereotypical information about various groups of people. And it's essential that we are on top of that to ensure that it doesn't impact the way that he views himself and other people. So we had to remain vigilant. And I was, you know, reminded me that, you know, we just had to continue to teach him, continue to water the seeds that we had planted in him, right? And also continue to have faith that if we stay the course, if we continue to consciously cultivate his consciousness, to affirm him, to love him, that God will ensure that there will be no force in this world that will be able to take him off the path of becoming the strong, proud change agent that we know God has destined him to be.
We gon' be all right. Do you hear me? Do you hear me? All right. We gon' be all right.
Huh? Y'all, give it up, give it up, give it up.
We gon' be all right. Do you hear me?
I'm not gonna lie, Anthony. I was triggered when I heard that story from the very first time. And my wife and I'm a Christian, and my wife, she's like an Israelite, you know, not the Nick Cannon kind, right? But so I was very concerned about the differences in our relationship. Look, I was also reminded to tell everyone to go to Cash App if you'd like to donate to the foundation. It is Shortcuts Show 17. All right, the Shortcut Show with a K, 17. Apparently there were 16 other Shortcut Show with a K. They're not very creative around this part, all right? Now, if you would, please put your hands together for our next speaker. Y'all, please give it up for Mr. Eric Jefferson.
Around the sun, the earth knows she's revolving, and the rosebuds know the bloom in early May.
I'll never forget my senior year of high school, my last football game, 10 degrees outside, two teams, coaches, and two people in the stands. It was so cold outside, the band didn't even show up to march. I look up in the stands, and I see my father in this snowsuit with snow boots cheering me on. When I looked up in the stands and I saw my dad, it was in that moment I said, I want to be a father to my kids like my father was to me. I learned a valuable lesson that day, that presence means everything when it comes to being a father. With that example at home, I followed in my father's footsteps in so many ways, or trying to at least. My father was a chemist. I became a chemical engineer before fulfilling my full purpose of becoming a lifelong educator. My father became a pastor. I became a pastor. My father instilled in me to live a purposeful life, and your life should have meaning and meaning for others. So I began as a youth pastor, starting a full two-time tutoring center with GED courses at my church. I was tutoring high school students in math and chemistry, and I found myself falling in love with educating kids. And many of my students, I became father figures to. Tutoring became more purposeful for me than engineering. So the summer of 2002, I stopped being an engineer to walk in my purpose. Fall of 2002, I get hired as a teacher assistant while finishing up some degrees. My wife, Stacy, is pregnant with our first child, Aaron Alexis, my daughter. Things are looking up. I have my daughter in October, and in March, I get fired. Fired. Like, I ain't never been fired from a job before. I felt rejected. And all I could think about is what I'm going to do. I got a wife that I have to take care of. I have a newborn, five-month-old baby that I could take care of. How can I be a husband and a father without a job? I felt helpless at that moment. I didn't know what to do but depend on God and have faith in God. And it was in my faith during this time I had to learn patience, that God uses rejection as a catalyst to thrust us to the next level of purpose. So I realized one thing, that I had to trust in God. October, that 2 months later, I get my first teaching job. Boy, I took a pay cut. Oh, I took a large pay cut, but it was okay because I finally was walking and my purpose. October 2005, I have my second child, my son. I got my boy. Now I have the dream family in America. I got my boy and my girl, two paying jobs, two loving parents. They're 15 months old. My son wasn't walking or talking. So here we are, taking him back and forth to the doctor's office. Primary care physician couldn't figure out why. And so we were waiting in the doctor's office one time in the waiting room. So she told us, she said, take your son to the ENT doctor. So we did. We taking him back and forth to the ENT doctor. No one knows. We even got the speech therapist involved. We got parent for teachers involved. Sitting in the ENT office, and the doctor comes out and tells your son is going to need a series of surgeries. I'm thinking to myself, my son is 15 months old. How in the world is he going to go under the knife at 15 months old? One of the scariest moments as a parent, because at that moment, I felt that I could not be there with my son when they rolled him to the surgery room, to the operating room. So in that moment, I knew my faith was tested again. I knew I had to trust in God again. And as they roll him off, I'm crying, saying, will I ever see my son again? Now, my son wasn't talking before the surgery. But 14 years later, I can't even get him to be quiet. So then in the fall of 2010, kids are in school. I'm working as a youth pastor at the church. And I'm beginning to feel the call of pastor on my life. My mom and dad had moved to Maryland where my father had started the church. And he was calling me, and I felt God calling me to move. I discussed moving to Maryland to fulfill the pastor call of my life with my wife, Stacy, and God had would have it in 2012. I got a job offer from Baltimore City Public Schools. I sat down with my wife, and we both agreed that we would move first. I would move first. Then once I bought the house and got everything established, the kids will come, and then she will follow. Summer of 2012, the kids moved to Maryland so I can get them enrolled in school. But at this moment, my wife was still in St. Louis. We set a date for Stacy to come in 2013. But other than visiting every 6 weeks, she didn't move to Maryland. Each year, we would set a date for her to come. That date will come and go, and she never came. So for 4 years of raising my kids on my own, 4 years I saw my kids hurting and crying, and all I can do is cry with them. My son would ask me, Daddy, when mommy coming home? My daughter would watch her cousins go on outings with their mothers, but my daughter would have to go on outings with her grandmother instead. So while everybody else is doing mother-daughter outings, she's doing grandmother-daughter outings or granddaughter-grandmother outings. It's painful to see my kids suffering. And at that moment, I felt so inadequate as a father. Why? Because I felt like I couldn't shelter them from the hurt. But also, too, I felt like I couldn't live up to the expectations of being a pastor. And I couldn't live up to the expectations and be able to keep my family together and my marriage together like my father did. So I felt like I felt let my father down. But I should have saw this coming, because our marriage was shaky prior to me moving, but I thought a fresh start in a new location would do us some good. So it was hard for me, because I felt like it didn't measure up as a man, as a husband, as a father, because I couldn't shelter my kids from all of this hurt and pain. My father, all I can do at this time was be the best parent for my kids, just like him. This is where I learned that being present is more important than being a parent that's buying clothes and shoes. So every day I made sure that my kids had a home-cooked meal, eating dinner together at 6 o'clock, watching Family Feud, playing board games and doing things to interact. I was that dance dad for my daughter. I'm that gymnastics father for my son. And everywhere they go, I go. Even if I have to miss church because my daughter's in the dance recital, my son has a gymnastics competition. That's where I'm at. I want to be there. I am there physically and emotionally for them at all times. Being a single father has an uphill journey, because being that custodial parent, y'all know what I'm talking about. You're the rule enforcer. You're the disciplinary and more. So kids sometimes tend to gravitate to the non-custodial parent. And it makes me feel inadequate. Makes me feel like I'm under the microscope. But I kept doing what I knew what to do was best for my kids. I kept being their dad, and I kept moving and working towards my purpose. Through the pains of single parenthood and divorce, I was elevated to pastor of Emmanuel Temple Church in 2016 and the principal of North County High School. And there it is, pastor, principal, and parent, my own alliteration in life. My purpose is not only to change the lives of my students, but also changing the lives of people and setting my kids up for success. People ask me all the time, how do you do it? I say, do what? Be a parent, a principal, and a pastor. And I always tell them this, it's grace for the grind.
Yeah, give it up, give it up. Keep grinding. Woo! Right. That was my dance dad for my daughter. Hey, dance dad tonight. Wait, wait, they talking about me? I'm a dance dad. Yeah, we out here. Ain't nothing to be streamed up. Yeah, I really related to your story, man. I was I'm a teacher also. All right, so I work with kids and all that. So that is a wonderful thing. Being a teacher and a parent during quarantine, it's definitely not something we plan for. The only reason I got a job was so I could get away from them every now and then. All right, but now I'm here with them all the time. All right, I don't know what to do with that. I want to make sure that I give this next brother all the love and respect because he's got a name, a difficult name, kind of like mine. My name is Kiragu, K-I-Ragu, like spaghetti sauce. My grandmother called me kangaroo till I was six. All right, so I feel your pain that people mess up your name. Y'all, please give it up for my man, Mr. Felix Klimpacher. All right, let's bring it back. Y'all, give it up for Mr. Keith Brown.
It was the spring of 1999, and I started dating a beautiful, black, brilliant, quintessential queen by the name of Wakia Nicole Champion, who everybody called Nikki. We met at a Black History program where I was the speaker and she was the soloist. And we clicked immediately because we were both educators. And I was preparing to step out on faith as a full-time professional speaker. A couple of months later, in the summer of 1999, I was elated and excited, but a little nervous at the same time because, you see, I was about to meet Nikki's son, a three-year-old promising prince by the name of Keon. And as the day drew nearer, I became more excited and more nervous at the same time. And when the day arrived, I drove up to Nikki's home and I got out of my car and my pace slowed as I walked towards the house, rang the doorbell. And she opened the door and she let me in and I stepped inside of her home. And out of nowhere, this three-year-old, beautiful, promising prince ran up to me, looked me in the eye and said, "Why are you here?" I was speechless. I didn't know what to say in that moment because never in a million years would I have imagined that question would come from a three-year-old. So I went to the couch, I sat down, and I beckoned him to come to me, and he did. I picked him up and I sat him on my lap and I said, I'm here to meet you. What is your name? And he said, Keon. And then he hugged me. And the weight of the world was off of my shoulders as I hugged him back. And I knew in that moment, it was a divine moment. I knew in that moment that he had accepted me. And it was a divine moment, not only because he accepted me, but because I was 30 and he was 3. And numbers meant something. And both of those numbers are divine in my Christian walk. And so over the course of the next couple of years, I had the privilege and the honor of taking Keon to his first day of pre-K. I had the honor and the privilege of going to PTA meetings. I was intentional about being that dad that showed up at the PTA meetings and all of the programs that Keon was in. I had the honor of going to the first day of school when he was in kindergarten. I was excited about it. I had the honor of buying his school clothes when he was a little boy. I had the honor of being there, not as his father by sperm, but I was his father by spirit, because I knew that my spirit was greater than my sperm. Yes, I wasn't there when Keon took his first steps, but I was there every step of the way as he traveled his educational journey throughout K-12. I mean, when he was in elementary school, I would take he and his friends on a carpool and I would drive them to school. And before Keon got out of the car, I would say, I love you. And he would say, I love you more. And I would say, no, I love you more. And he would say, I love you till the new earth comes. Man. How do you beat that? How can you even deal with that? So that was the end of the conversation. And as Keon got older, I would take him when he was in high school along with his friends, and I would teach them these affirmations like, I love myself. I believe in myself. I'm proud of myself. I'm a genius. I love myself. I believe in myself. I'm proud of myself. I'm a genius. And they would say those affirmations, and then they would get out of the car, and Keon would always get out of the car last in high school. And I would say, I love you, son. And Keon would say, deuces. You see, it wasn't cool for him to say, I love you at that point. Yes, he would get out of the car after saying peace, not knowing that on the inside, I didn't have peace. For you see, I felt inadequate as a man. I felt inadequate as a man because my lovely wife and I had lost 2 children, 2 babies. I felt inadequate because my 2 fathers that I grew up with in a blended family, 2 mothers, 2 fathers, brothers and sisters on both sides. See, I grew up with my bonus dad who showed me love, but I couldn't fully accept his love because I was still longing for the love from my biological father. Yes, yes, I decided that I would be Keon's father. His F-A-T-H-E-R, not his F-A-R-T-H-E-R. See, you got to understand that in 1999, I pledged my love to be his father. In 2002, Nikki and I were married. And on that day, I made a covenant. I made a covenant, not just with my wife. I made a covenant with God and my wife and Keon to love him and to protect and nurture him to be his father. And so I did that in elementary school. I did it in middle school. I did it in high school, but I still did not have that inner peace. And because of that, I ended up on a couch. No, not a couch at home. I ended up on the couch of my therapist. Yes, I was going through bouts of being oppressed, repressed, suppressed, and depressed. And yes, even though I made peace with both of my fathers, because you see, my biological father, we made peace. And when I saw him, I remember he used to kiss me on the cheek. My other dad, my bonus dad, would always ask if he could check my homework. And he would always say, did you do your homework? See, they loved me, but I had issues with both of them. But I came to grips with that. And I love both of them on this day, but I still felt inadequate. I still felt inadequate as a man. And it's ironic that my beautiful son would end up on the same couch with the same therapist, because in his adolescent years, he felt inadequate. During his adolescent years, at some point, he went through a bout of depression. And yes, there were those family members who said, child, he don't need no therapist. All y'all need to do is have faith and pray about it. Oh, yes. We prayed about it. Yes, we meditated as a family. Yes, we had faith, but I understood that faith without works is dead. As that father, I knew that I had to be the one to ascertain and embrace the fact that Black mental health matters. I couldn't listen to all the family members. I couldn't listen to all the family members who said he didn't need therapy. No, I wasn't going to listen to all that tradition. I was going to give my son what my son needed to go, to glow and to grow. And he did. And so years later, I would ask my son and we would reminisce. We would reminisce and we would reflect. We would reflect as we sat on the couch at home. We would reflect about how every 3 months when he was growing up, I would say, what type of father have I been? And sometimes I liked the answer and sometimes I didn't like the answer. But each and every day I worked to be a better father. I worked to improve in the sight of my son. See, there were times when we sat on that couch and we cried together and we leaned on each other's shoulder and we hugged each other. But then there were other times when we battled over who was better, the New York Giants or the Chicago Bears. See, I'm a Giants fan. And I used to tell Keon, man, how can you like the Chicago Bears? They ain't won a championship since 1985. The Giants won a championship. The only team in the NFL history that won a championship in four different decades. See, I would beat him in two-hand spades. You see, I would love on my son and he would love on me. And today, my son is a director of policy and community engagement in the Georgia Senate. Today, my son is a program coordinator for the National Lighthouse Foundation. Today, my son helps to coordinate the initiatives for our national program, Fathers Not Father. Today, my son has become like a mentor to me. Today, my son is over any bout of depression. And as a family, we are building and we are working together. You see, my son now travels around the country and around the world on tour with me. And it's such a blessing because now my son can get to see why I am here. He can get to see why I was not home all of those years while he was growing up. I would be on the road making a better life for my wife and my son. And now my son understands. You see, when I think about my son's question back in the summer of 1999, when he said, why are you here? I know without a shadow of a doubt, I am here to protect my son. I am here to reflect my son. I am here to respect my son. And I'm here never to neglect my son. That's why I'm here.
Gotta give it up. Keith. My apologies, Keith, messing up your name earlier. And you chose the wrong frat. All right. You chose the right frat when you became a dad. All right. So my apologies for that. Yeah, if I was gonna message you, I'd have been like, yo, here is Cedric the Entertainer. Bring it coming down, Cedric the Entertainer. Give it for a second. Y'all thought it was Cedric, didn't you? At home, y'all did. I don't
ain't nobody in the house with you. It's just me and you. Come on. You know what I'm saying? All right, y'all. Now we're going to go ahead. We want to make sure that we're all getting the help we need. All right. He mentioned some very important things in there about therapy. All right. It's something that that's frowned upon in our community, and it doesn't need to be. Y'all, let's get better. All right. Let's do this. Let's grow together. All right, y'all, please, let's continue that energy that we have, Keith, and give it up for my man, Mr. Felix Klimpacher.
It was dark by the time I walked through the front door. I had been sitting in my car for the last 30 minutes just collecting myself. It was a ritual I had developed to steel myself for whatever I was going to face once I walked through that front door. I smelled the food cooking and walked into the kitchen. When are you going to tell the kids? No hello, no how was your day. When are you going to tell the kids? After New Year's, I said, no sense in ruining the holidays. No, you need to tell them now. Felicia, Carson, come downstairs. Your father wants to tell you something. My kids came down to the living room and they seemed strangely excited. It wasn't until later that I learned that they thought I was gonna tell them we were going to Disney World. It was something we had discussed the week before. Instead, I looked at my two babies and told them, your mom and I are separating after 18 years. But I would always be there for them, no matter what. My 10-year-old son looked shocked. My 15-year-old daughter had a blank stare on her face. My son crawled into my lap and just gave me a hug. I tried to remain calm, but I was screaming on the inside. After a while, my daughter turned to me and said, Dad, can we go for a drive? I just need to get out of here. We drove through the streets of DC in silence. And then she turned to me and said, what took you so long, Dad? You stayed way longer than I would have. I was shocked. I thought we had been careful to hide all of the arguments, all the disagreements from the kids, but I guess the kids know. What had taken me so long? I was raised by a single mother. My father was gone by the time I was 5. My mother tried to be both my father and my mother. Sometimes I think we had more than the kids who had both parents at home. She gave us everything that we needed. My mother was at every sporting event that I participated in, tennis, soccer, swimming. She was there, but I always noticed the other boys in the stands with their fathers. My older brother, Franz, and my uncles did their best to stand in, and I will always be grateful to them. They are my examples of Black manhood, fatherhood, and how to be a husband. I swore to myself I would never be like my father. I would always be there for my kids. Becoming a father was a profound moment for me. I cut the umbilical cord for both of my kids, and I held them even before their mother. Their lives were a gift to me, and in that moment, I became a man. When they came home, I did the night shift to give their mother a break. I changed diapers, I fed them, I rocked them to sleep, and eventually those many trips to the ER for a fever or a cut or a bruise. My daughter, she's very much like me. Sometimes I even know what she's thinking before she even opens her mouth. My son, it's a little harder. He comes out of left field sometimes. As they grew older and we would go out on our excursion, they were my role dogs, we would get the compliments that a lot of Black fathers get. How wonderful it is to see a Black father doing the right thing with his kids. I wish more Black fathers were like you. While it was well-intentioned, it was kind of insulting. Many of the Black fathers I knew in my circles were doing the right thing. It was the absentee father that was the anomaly. I was at every doctor's appointment, dance practice and recital, basketball practice and every basketball game, parent-teacher conference and school event, I was present. when my kids woke up in the middle of the night from nightmare or just needing to be comforted, it was my bedside that they came to so I could kiss whatever hurt and make the discomfort go away. But what had taken me so long? It was that promise I made to myself. I would not be my father. I would be there for my kids. It was the fear of ending up alone that made me stay in a dysfunctional marriage way longer than I should have. You think you're hiding things from the kids. You tell them, do as I say and not as I do. But they are reflections of you and they will do what you do. Yes, I was present, but I was not myself, my best self. I was depressed, was overweight, I had high blood pressure, I was pre-diabetic, and had a pack-a-day smoking habit. That's what my kids saw. After the separation and eventual divorce, I was starting all over. Courts are not very equitable to fathers. I gave up the house and was ordered to pay child support. I became the non-custodial parent, despite my many requests to the contrary. Even though we're not in the same house, I was determined that I would be there for them and be the best version of myself. I had been a father who was physically and emotionally unwell. I set out to become a better example and father. I began a journey to be healthy and present. I sought counseling. It was the most difficult thing that I've ever done, but it was necessary. I needed to unburden myself of the emotional baggage that comes with being in a dysfunctional relationship. I had to look in the mirror. It takes two. It's never one person's fault. I had to examine my own relationship with my father. And I really learned to appreciate the saying, the boy is father to the man. I'm still at every recital or basketball game, and I take every chance to be with my kids. They keep me hip in music and current in social media. Facebook and Instagram are apparently out and TikTok is in, but it's a two-way street. My daughter appreciates my 90s music, and every once in a while I hear her singing Mary J. Blige or SWV down the hall. My son, I'm still working on him. How he ended up a Patriots fan and I'm a Cowboys fan, I will never know. But one thing I could say, he is his own man. Being a father, a good father, is about being present and in the moment, taking those late night calls and just listening, or giving hugs and holding on to your kids and telling them that you love them. I am now the proud father of a 20-year-old junior at Norfolk State University, where she's majoring in music production, and a new high schooler who has dreams and aspirations of playing varsity basketball. We've all come a long way, but I think I'm a better father and role model for the things that I've done. My biggest challenge these days is teaching my son how to be a black man in today's America, how to survive an encounter with the police, how to manage his money and save for the future or a rainy day and be an entrepreneur, and how to manage and value relationships. No man is an island. I'm not just talking the talk, but I'm walking the walk. I'm trying to show them by example. After 30 years of a pack-a-day smoking habit, I quit. I've lost 75 pounds and I have way more to go. I no longer have high blood pressure or am I pre-diabetic. I've learned to listen to myself, both physically and emotionally. I've even reconnected with my own father. We are working on our relationship and we've both gone through our own transformations. Him realizing everything that he has missed out on in all these years, and me trying not to miss out on anything with my kids. We've all got a long way to go, but we're on the right path. The ultimate compliment I get from my kids is, I see you, Dad, living your best life. What had taken me so long? A promise to myself to always be there for my kids. But there are many ways to achieve that. Just be there when they need me and be present in their lives. My daughter always tells me that I am her best friend, and my standard response to her is, No, baby. Friends, they come and go. We are forever. And that is a promise.
You know I love music. And every time I hear something hot,
yeah,
it makes me want to move. It makes me want to have fun. But it's something about this joint right here. This joint right here, it makes me want to...
Fire emoji on the screen. I don't know how you do it. You doing it from your end. All right. That shirt is hot fire. That's how you show somebody how to be a black man in America. Buy that shirt. All right. I love that. All right. One great thing about the storytellers that I'm really connecting to how y'all are putting in the work. All right. Y'all are doing the things that are difficult. You're confronting your own demons, and that right there is something your kids are going to see, and that's going to translate. All right, so good job, y'all. Keep it up. All right, y'all, please, let's try and keep this same positive energy going. Keep the same positive energy going wherever you're at, in your seat, in your house, in your slippers. Put your hands together for our next speaker, David Marshall.
When I first saw you, I said, oh my, I said, oh my, that's a dream, that's my dream, I needed a dream when it all seemed to go bad.
A dream. What a perfect, perfect dream. I've always been a dreamer. I believe one of the many ways that God speaks to us is through our dreams. God gave me two very lofty dreams in life. One to be an opera singer and the other to be a dad. I became an opera singer and father was next on the list. Now, much like one of our former presidential hopefuls, Elizabeth Warren, I am a planner. So to become a father, I definitely had a plan, and adoption was always the plan. So the question really became, when was the time right? And for me, in January of 2015, there was something in my spirit that said, it's the time. So I went to a meeting at Adoptions Together. I walked into a room full of parental hope. And much like my parents always said on the first day of school, always sit in the front of the class, which can be recognized. So I sat in the front of that classroom and I heard a lot of information. I mean, a lot of information. And it was quite overwhelming. So on my way home, I had a lot to process. When I got home that night, I was still processing. I got into my bed that night. I took out the papers that they gave us and I began to look through these papers. And as many of you know, adoption can be kind of an expensive process. So at that point in time, I really just wanted to get to the bottom line. How much is this going to cost me was the question. So I looked, I saw that cost, and I said, I need to go. There was no decision that was going to be made that night. I went to sleep, and God began to trouble my sleep with this word. And the word was sacrifice. Many of you who are parents know that there is no sacrifice too great when it comes to our children. So the next morning I woke up and I knew what I needed to do. I went to the Adoptions Together website and I applied. And I got my first acceptance within 24 hours. And the journey began. I was given an adoption portal. Let me tell you about that portal. The portal holds a series of documents or tasks. And when I opened it, I saw task after task after task. I couldn't even count the tasks. And then when you click on one of the tasks, there seemed to be about 50 subtasks. Again, I had to ask God some questions because it seemed a little bit overwhelming for me. Was I really supposed to do this? And God put that word back in my spirit. That word was sacrifice. So I started those tasks. During that process, there was also the home study. The home study involves a social worker coming into your home. Now, the thought of a social worker coming into my home was quite frightening because I had to think, what are they in here looking for? Are they coming to look for dust in the corner, rings around the tub? And anyone who knows me knows I'm a very meticulous housekeeper, so you wouldn't find that anyway, but you just began to think crazy thoughts when someone is coming into your home, especially a stranger. Well, she wasn't coming to see any of that, not that she'd have found it, but she was coming to learn about me. She wanted to know my story from childhood into an adult. And then, of course, why I wanted to be a father. And yes, she did take a tour of my home, really just to see if my home was a loving home fit for a child. Well, I think she did find that, because within about 2 months, I got the first of two amazing phone calls. That phone call was telling me that I had been accepted into the domestic infant program at Adoptions Together. My God. So what that meant was, at any moment, I could get the phone call that I was going to be a dad. So my phone and I were inseparable. Now, this became probably the most emotionally taxing part of that journey, because I was waiting for a while. A year passed, nothing. My mind got the best of me. I called my agency and spoke to my placement social worker, and I asked her, could I come in to speak with her? And she said, of course. I go in and I sit down and I said, you know, it's been a year and nothing. Is it maybe because I'm gay? Is it because I'm single? What is it? Why is it that no one wants me? She kind of chuckled and she stopped and she said, David, none of that is the case. It's about timing. And when the time is right, your baby will come. So just be patient and know that the baby is on the way. I left feeling a huge weight lifted off of my shoulders, because I knew that my baby was on the way. So let's fast forward about 6 months. I was a music teacher. I had a fifth grade music class in my classroom. My phone was sitting on my desk, and I noticed in the middle of instruction that my phone was vibrating. I looked, and I saw my social worker's name on that phone. Now, I knew she was not calling to ask if we wanted to go have lunch, have some coffee. This was probably the phone call. So at that moment, it was a question of professional responsibility or go take this phone call. Well, I flung something up on YouTube. We thank God for technology. And I chose a lack of professional responsibility, and I ran out on my babies, and I went into that hallway and I called my social worker back. She said, David, I didn't think you'd want to miss this phone call. We have a 2-week-old baby boy by the name of Josiah who needs a daddy. I lost it. I was in the middle of the hallway at school, and I was doing my best carrying on. So when I gathered myself, my social worker said, there's just one more thing left to be done. Josiah's birth parents, yes, parents, birth mother and father, they want to meet. I said, of course, this is amazing. So a few days later, I go to the agency to meet his parents. This might sound a tad strange to you, but I was in love with these two people immediately. Why, you might ask? Because they were about to bless me with the greatest dream, my biggest dream ever. They came into the room. I gave them both big hugs. We sat, we talked. They asked me amazing and pointed questions. Towards the end of that conversation, Josiah's birth mom became a bit emotional. I saw tears welling up in her eyes. So at that point, I took her hand and she said to me, David, how will Josiah know how much I love him? How will he know that I never wanted to give him up, that I never wanted to leave him? And I said, well, I'm not going anywhere. And if you're not going anywhere, we're going to do this together. At that point, I took out two gift bags and I placed them on the table. They opened their gift bags and they took out books, and those books were entitled, Guess How Much I Love You. And I said, these are the books that we will share. we will read these books to Josiah, and this will be our love story. This is the story that we will share with him of just how much we love him. Well, after documents, home study, and a year and a half wait, these two amazing people chose me to have the honor and privilege of parenting the best that they had, their little miracle, Josiah. April 3rd, 2017, I got to meet my baby for the very first time. I walked into the room and I saw these big, bright, beautiful eyes looking at me. And it was as if we knew that we were meant for each other. He belonged to me and I belonged to him, and we were going to be inseparable. I took him in my hands and hugged him and I kissed him. I was instantly in love with this little perfect baby. Well, 3 years have gone past and he is still the picture of perfection to me. Half the time I'm in awe because I don't know how one little being can have just that much energy, but I do all I can do to keep up with him. We are one. When he cries, I cry. When he smiles, I smile. Every decision that I make has Josiah intricately woven through it. You see, I gave up self 3 years ago when I became this little miracle's daddy. He is my joy. He is my delight. He is my everything. And I could not imagine a day without him. Josiah Paul Marshall, guess how much I love you. Daddy loves you so much.
David Marshall, y'all. David Marshall. David, thank you. Thank you for everything that you're doing. Thank you for everything that you do. Thank you for sharing your story. All right. Thank you. Those types of things are. Yeah, the bees are coming in and out on me. That's how y'all want to do me. I'm trying to get all soft and mushy and all. Y'all just bringing the music back in. That's fine. That's how we gonna do. Look, this next person, y'all, please, once again, David, thank you. This next speaker is actually the father of one of the people on our production team, and I'm not trying to make light of how the person on the production team speaks or anything, but you know, we were talking about something. He kept saying Barbara, Barbara. I was thinking he was taking like a haircut, and he's like Barbara, Baba Baba. And he was like, oh no. He was like Baba Baba. And I couldn't quite, I didn't understand that he was saying this was his Baba, all right, his father. All right. And it is like sitting down and just like injecting a whole book into your head. I loved every moment meeting this man. So please, y'all generate that energy. Y'all give it up for Baba Rawle Gibbons.
Father's Day, 2004. What would be characteristic of a good father? To me, it would be one who cares for all his soul for his family. One who would never desert his loved ones, makes time for them, no matter what. A father would know when something is wrong with his family, His daughters would be able to talk to him, ask him anything without fear of his getting angry. All the unconditional love and time this certain father gives his family shows that he's a wonderful father. In case you did not realize it, Daddy, these characteristics match you. I think you're a wonderful father. The fact is, I was not. I spent a lot of my life being surer of what I was not rather than what I was. Let me take my father for instance. I was nothing like my father in terms of what he could do. He was a fixer of things, engines, machines, things around the house, whatever. That was his gift. At his work, he was a boss. At home, however, he knew who was the boss. All you ask, all your mother. Caribbean homes, you see, are the domain of women. And ours was no exception. My mother raised 8 children, 6 girls, 2 boys, with a great deal of love, and in equal doses, a great deal of licks. You all know the term straightening? Well, in the 50s, before the Black Power movement, Black women used to go to the hairdresser to have her put a hot iron comb in their hair to straighten the kinks out. You could hear the hair sizzle and scream. Well, bringing up children was something like that. They had to be straightened out with licks. And if the home didn't manage it, there was always the schoolmaster with his whip. And if that failed, well, prison and the cat of nine tails. I was straightened out, well straightened out at home. But straightened out to do what? I mean, I had no aptitude or inclination to follow in my father's footsteps. And I had no particular skill. So I left home with a head full of questions. By the time I got married to my wife, Pat, and we started having a family, we were certain about one thing, and that is that we would not institute licks as a form of bringing up our children. That was an old relic from the slave days. There was something else too. By that time, I had discovered my own passion for making theater, and I devoted a lot of time to it. I was very fortunate. In fact, I considered myself very lucky because I had daughters. And of course, daughters are the responsibility of the mother, right? Tell that to my daughters. They didn't agree. They tried everything to teach me otherwise. They wrote letters, they drew pictures and painted paintings. They took me to task. They made me Project Daddy. Okay, so take that letter I just read. That was from my last daughter, Roland Orisha. Here she was, telling me what I knew myself not to be. It wasn't flattery or, as we say in Trinidad, mama guy. It was really the father that she saw in me. But the question for me was, how could I become that father? I know I had a track record by that time. Eh? My first daughter, Tinuke, her letter is imprinted here. Daddy, you remember those days? I mean, before the teenage years, you were just somebody to be afraid of. I was scared to be around you because I could never do anything right. So we had abolished the institution of LICS, but the old legacy of fear, the old slavery ways still remained. My second daughter, Adeola, she would have none of it. She rebelled. Everybody's afraid of you. We don't know what mood you will come home in. And when you come home, there's nothing that we can do to please you. I'm fed up. That child presented me with a mirror of my own tyranny. I was humbled. You know, in the wisdom of our African tradition, we say that the soul chooses its head, that means its purpose or its destiny, before coming to earth. It means that the child chooses the parent. And in coming through the passage of birth, we disremember those choices. I really wondered about the wisdom of my own children in choosing me, so inadequate a man, as their father. I sort of, you know, reasoned that maybe it's really the mother that they choose and the father is just, you know, the luck of the draw. The gap between myself and my children was this wide. My third daughter, Aisana, she helped to bridge that gap. She presented me with this. Don't be distracted by the good looks. Look at what is written underneath it, at the bottom. My daddy. That child was born with the gift of unconditional love. She stretched out her hand, and that helped me to cross that bridge and to meet on the other side my last daughter, Rawlan Orisha. She carries my name, and she claimed me. When that child was 2 months old, I was taking her to the nursery for the first time. And when we just separated, I felt a tug in my navel. I imagine that's the way mothers feel. And I recognized that in order to be a father, I had first to become a mother. In our tradition, we say that the child chooses its parents so that we can allow the child to manifest its destiny. We provide that space for that to happen. But the child also chooses the parent to bring us to our better selves. And it's from this perspective that I can say that a boy becomes a man when he faces his father. A man becomes a father when he faces his children. A father, however, becomes an ancestor only when his children face him. I am at 70. In sight of the crossroads of ancestorship, I stand in the gaze, the full gaze of my children, all of them, those who chose me in coming to this earth and who give me a second chance, those four with my grandchildren, 7 of them, those who chose me on their journey, during their journey on this earth. The first of them being Awoshope, Mark Laveau, who gave me the title and the honor of Baba, which means karaoke, father. He's also fathering me right now through this whole process of truth telling. I stand as well at this time in the gaze of my ancestors. They are here with me. There's one of them who, in her latter years of dementia, she would take off all her clothes and run through the house stark naked. She would have to be restrained. The night, however, she's free to speak. When you get to that crossroads, you stand alone, naked, stripped of secrets, free of fear, no theater, no talent, no masquerade, no mama guy, no religion, no ritual. You stand, you one, facing the only question that matters. What have you done with the gift? The gift that every single soul brings to this earth. What have you done with the gift of love?
Y'all thought I was playing. Y'all thought I was playing. That it's like an ejection of knowledge. Like, that's a blessing. I know you felt that. All right. If you're not, you're stupid. All right. If you're sitting at home, you didn't feel anything, you're stupid right now. All right. That was amazing. Baba, how do you do that? You have bars. Okay. I don't know if you know that term. It's bars. It means like a person spitting. You don't know that term. It means like you are really saying like the good stuff. All right. And you, man, how do you do it? Yes. Oh, they put him on the screen real quick. How you do that? Do that again. Yes, bruh. I don't have time to do that right now, but that, yes, that was amazing. It made me want to listen. All right. And I want to know how to talk like that so that my kids will listen to me. All right, because right now I asked my daughter her favorite rapper. She's like the guy from Hamilton. All right, I need your help, Baba. All right, you gotta help me save my children from themselves. Yes, I try to tell them about Mobb Deep. All right, y'all, please make sure that y'all put your hands together for our final speaker. All right, we have a talk back later on. Make sure y'all check in for that. Give it up for our final speaker. Mr. Al Burton.
I love basketball. I mean, I love sports in general, but basketball for me is special. See, most of my childhood memories are my father taking me to basketball practices and basketball games. He used to drive all over the city just so I could play in different leagues and tournaments. And even when I wasn't good enough to play anymore competitively, he'd still take me to games and we would just sit in the stands and watch together as fans. Basketball was our thing. And if I ever had a son, it was going to be our thing too. So when my wife and I found out that we were having a boy, I was elated. I know people always talk about the special bond between fathers and daughters, and Don't get me wrong. If the doctor told us we were having a girl, I would have been just as happy. But a boy, a son, that meant that I'd have the opportunity to give to him what my father gave to me, basketball. And I couldn't wait. Now, the day my son Blake was born, it was the happiest day of my life, without question. But that joy pretty quickly started to turn to fear. You see, for the first time, I was responsible for a real life, a real person. And if I'm being honest, I had no idea what to do. After the first couple of weeks, my wife and I figured out that we would figure it out eventually. And by week three, man, I was already having hoop dreams. Blake was a late walker, but that didn't stop me from running out and buying that little tights basketball rim. And at 18 months, not long after he took his first steps, I was already teaching him how to run up to that rim and dunk the ball. I even raised it up a little bit higher than it should have been because I wanted to challenge him. I know. Typical basketball dad, right? I was already prepping him to play above his grade level. Like most fathers, I used to imagine all the things I would do with my son. I was going to give him my best qualities and then some. He was going to be a better version of me. I was going to give him my love of basketball, and when the time was right, I was going to teach him how to play. See, I've always had this theory that the height was more closely tied to the maternal side of the family, and my wife's father is 6'4". Most of the men in her family are about that tall. I myself, I'm 6'1", so the way I see it, Blake's going to be at least 6'3". And if you know anything about basketball, you know that's just the right height for a point guard. I imagine myself traveling all over the city, taking him to different games and practices and leagues, just like my father did with me. I imagine us watching games together, cheering for the Bulls. I tell him about the game when I was a kid, and we'd argue about who was greater, Michael Jordan or whoever the best player might be at the time. Truthfully, I even imagine he might be that player. I was going to be watching him play for years, or so I hoped. Because Blake was a late walker, my wife and I started to question his development. We also had some concerns because he'd become really agitated and loud in crowded places. And there were other odd behaviors as well, like how he'd notice the most unnoticeable thing in the room and then he'd lock his eyes on it and pace back and forth without ever losing focus on whatever that thing was, or how he'd swing his head from side to side as if he were following something in the air, except there was never anything there or nothing that we could see. He also used to walk on his toes a lot, even though he was more than capable of walking flat-footed. Now, I gotta admit, that one excited me a little bit because I've seen plenty of hoopers who walked on their toes, and that usually meant that they had hops. But in a child, it can also be a sign that there's some sort of developmental delays. So the culmination of all these things led us to have him evaluated by a developmental pediatrician. That image I had of my son, the one of him being the next great basketball phenom, it never materialized. At the age of 2, we learned that Blake had a sensory processing disorder. And by the time he was 4, he was officially diagnosed with Asperger's syndrome. Asperger's is a high-functioning form of autism, and autism is a neurological disorder that impacts what's considered to be normal development of the brain. People with autism typically struggle with communication, social interaction, and all sorts of physical activities. People with autism don't often play team sports. When I first learned about Blake's difference, I felt guilt. I feared that his autism was something that he had gotten from me. Instead of giving him the best of me, I feared that I had given him my worst. I thought back to my childhood and even my adult life, and I examined all of my own quirks and oddities, and I wondered if those things were somehow linked to Blake's autism. People with autism also have this thing they do called stimming. It's a self-regulating behavior that helps them cope with an oversensitivity to normal, everyday environmental stimulus. Now, when Blake stims, it often involves him running around or skipping in circles for minutes at a time while humming and flailing his hands in the air. He also has extreme emotional responses and moments of anxiety, and those moments can come about from something as harmless as saying "Blake" in a tone that implies that he's done something wrong. When I see these things, I'm no longer imagining Blake on the basketball court. I imagine him on the street. I imagine him interacting with the police officer in the same way we saw Elijah McClain, also an introvert, just like Blake. I imagine him as a Black teenager living in a world that might see his differences as threats, or at the very least, won't understand them and might cause him harm as a result. Now, I try not to have these thoughts because I really don't want to claim them, but the Black father in me, I just can't afford not to. I wanted to give my son basketball, and instead I gave him this. I also felt guilty because deep down, a part of me still wanted that basketball player. Anyone who knows me expected my child to at least love the game, even if he wasn't good at it. It's the first question I would get at family functions. What sport's he gonna play? Or I know you're teaching him how to hoop. And if I'm being honest, I kind of felt a little bit embarrassed by what I couldn't say in response. Blake doesn't play basketball, and he doesn't watch it much either. Chances are he never will. On the rare occasion that he watches any part of a game with me, he's only interested in watching the score change. See, he loves numbers and he likes to calculate how many points it'll take the losing team to catch up. He even sometimes likes to pick the winner based on that calculation. And though he never gets to the end of a game, believe it or not, most of the time, he's right. He loves to read books and watch funny videos. He loves slapstick comedy because he struggles with nuance and physical comedy is easier for him to understand. His favorite subjects in school are math and vocabulary. And as a third grader, he was the runner-up in his all-school spelling bee. And he attends a classical school for academically gifted students, so his competition was pretty stiff. Blake is now 9 years old. He's a year younger than I was when I first started playing bitty basketball. He's tall for his age. He's got long arms and long fingers. And when most people see him, the first thing they think is, boy, he's got a prototypical basketball body. But while they see the next Kevin Durant, I just see Blake. Nowadays, when I hear people talk about all the time they spend taking their sons to all the different activities boys usually enjoy at that age, I just smile to myself. See, my schedule is also full, but instead of traveling to basketball games and basketball camps, I'm traveling from occupational therapy sessions to speech therapy sessions to behavioral therapy sessions. And instead of fighting with coaches over playing time, I'm fighting with schools over resources. And when we get a chance to just relax and have fun together, we aren't watching basketball. We're reading books or playing Little Alchemy, his favorite app on his iPad. Now, I still love basketball, but I love my son.
Yes, yes. Give it up. Give it up for Mr. Al Burton. Al Burton, y'all. Come on, wherever you are right now, you got time. Get your energy up. Get your energy up. We want to made it to the end of our show. All right, thank you, Al. I am a big basketball fan. I was feeling you on so much of that. Yes, that is as a teacher, I can say that everything that you said shows that you have been, you're going to be, that you are the type of parent that is going to jump every hurdle that you come to, because it's all about you and it's all about your environment and that you're creating for that child right now. And sounds like you're putting in the work. So thank you, brother. Thank you for doing that. All right. Y'all, right now is our time. We're going to go ahead and do our curtain call. All right, we're going to do our curtain call, y'all. So wherever you are in your slippers and your night robes, I don't care if you don't got no bottoms on, put your hands together. Put your hands together. All right, our first speaker, Anthony Outler. Yes, give it up, Anthony. Yes, yes, yes. Y'all better be clapping where you are. Don't have me just doing it. Y'all, Eric Jefferson, Eric Jefferson.
Yo.
Yeah. Oh, no, he's a capper. No, stop clapping. Stop clapping. I didn't know that. Oh. Y'all, give it up. Keith Brown, Keith Brown. Yeah. He's wearing gold boots right now, y'all. Keith Brown, Keith Brown. Yeah, give it up, give it up. Felix Klimpacher. Hey, fire emojis. Y'all didn't put the fire emojis up when I asked for them before, but I love it. I love it. Yeah, give it up. David Marshall. Hey, well, yeah, Dave. Yeah, I'm not gonna lie, I put the bow tie on because of this man right here. Yeah, I wear that same. Yeah, give it up, give it up, give it up. All right, y'all, give it up. Y'all, Baba Rawle Gibbons. Baba Rawle Gibbons, yes, yes, yes. That is not Dr. Sebe. He does not have a cure for cancer, y'all. All right, and finally, Al Burton. Yeah, give it up, Al Burton. Yeah. Game, all right. Dad Fred. Yeah. Dad Fred. Yeah. Yeah, I can see you. Y'all, everybody, y'all did an amazing job. All right. Amazing, amazing story. Yeah. I'm hearing like some type of extra sound in there, and that ain't me. I'm keeping it going. Y'all, we have come to the end of our show. All right. So I've got people talking to me on my left, people talking to me on my right. I want to make sure that we give our respect to all of our storytellers. All right. We want to go ahead and see if we can get Darnell up here. All right, let's see if we can get him up. Let's see if we can get him up. Good. Please put your hands together for the creator of the storytelling series. Y'all, give it up. Got you, Lamar. Yeah, yeah. Come on, yeah, dude. Yeah.
We are in the building. Yes, 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 yes. Give it all. All right, TJ, let's bring that down. So you are going to call it in for a music so loud. So DJ, let's shout out DJ Leroy. So thank you, thank you, thank you. But do not leave. Stay right there. Stay right there because part two of the show, we got about 15 to 20 minutes because we have some amazing moderators. We're going to bring the storytellers back. But I'm so excited. I want to thank you all as the producer and the co-producer of this show. I'm so grateful and honored. Of course, during the time off, I had to rock my Grambling State University because real dads, real babas go to the G, Grambling State University. Shout out to all the HBCUs that are out there. So I'm excited about part two. Those storytellers were amazing. Shout out to Anthony, Eric, Keith Brown, Brother Felix, David Rawle, Brother Baba Rawle, and Brother Al Burton. I love all of those brothers. Thank you all for sharing your stories with us. They gave us a gift. These two other brothers who are about to come to the stage, they are giants in their own right. They are giants in their own right. Before I bring them up, I cannot help. I got to thank the dope host, the comedian, educator, activist, father. Let's give it up for Brother Karagu, who did an amazing job keeping the flow going. Now, one of the best parts of the show is you get a chance to talk to some of the dads, some of the babas, to the fathers. You get a chance to ask them some questions. So we have two of the dopest people that I know. I used to hang out with the brother for about 10 to 15 years. We ran an amazing company called the Urban Leadership Institute. He is a father of three. He and I went through our rites of passage together. He is a creator. The creator of an amazing curriculum called Dare to Be King.
He is from the great city of Baltimore, but currently my man, brother David C. Miller is in the building. So let's give it up for David C. Miller as he takes the stage as one of our moderators. And then coming up with David, then we also have that's going to join us as well, all the way from Louisiana. He also represents Grambling State University by way of Howard University, by way of Louisiana. Dr. Kevin Washington is well known all over the country. He is an amazing individual. He is an amazing individual who is going to actually, is going to bless us as well. But before I bring out those two giants, I have to introduce our amazing staff, because we could not do this show without some dope producers. What you all don't know is each one of the storytellers had a storytelling coach. They are not as speakers. These people were storytellers, or as Baba Rao said, truth tellers. So each one of them had an amazing storyteller coach. So I want to start with one of our first storytelling coaches. Her name is Tuwari. So let's give it up for Tuwari. Let's give it up for the other storytelling coach, Angelica. Let's give it up for Danielle. We had an amazing set designer. If you come to our live show, you know we had an amazing set designer who's now is going virtual. Let's give it up for my homegirl by way of New York. Let's give it up for Kendra. Shout out to Kendra for an amazing set designer working with our team. And then we got to give it up for our DJ Leroy in the building, cutting the ones and twos. And even though we have some tech issues, DJ Leroy brought it to us. And then we also have also TJ, who's also another great tech person. TJ, I love this brother, was his teacher at one time. Shout out to also Devon Brown, our tech guru. Shout out to Devon Brown, Leonora, who helps out with our meditation practice and our mindfulness. And then let's give it up for the great director, all the way from Trinidad. Let's give it up for the great director. You cannot do this without a great director, Mark Laveau. Shout out to Mark Laveau for working so hard. And the man behind the scenes, if you ever watch Def Comedy Jam, I guess I'm like the Martin Lawrence, and this brother is like the Russell Simmons. He doesn't say a whole lot, but he works behind the scenes. My partner, the co-producer, one of the dopest designers, all the way from Maryland. Let's give it up for my man, Darius Wilmore, in the building. This is our amazing team. We brought this storytelling series to you live. And now what we want to do is we want to bring up our two moderators. So do not leave. Also, if you want to leave a donation, definitely leave a donation to Cash App. Also, thank you to Matt Pressbury and the Black Fathers Foundation for all the work that you've done for Black Fathers. Again, send some thank yous to our great storytellers and our storytelling coaches. You are amazing. And this show could not be possible without all of you all out there in the virtual space for joining us today, participating. So I want to bring up our moderators. I want to bring up these two giants who've been working with Black Fathers all over the country. I introduced them before. They're getting set up. They're getting ready. So those two brothers, I mentioned them, brother David Miller, and then also bring up Dr. Kevin Washington.
They're not in the building yet.
All right, so while we're waiting for David and Dr. David Miller and Kevin Washington to come, you know, you want to take a quick break, but come right back, because this is going to be an amazing part of the show. We're waiting for them to join us in the room right now. These two brothers are giants. The dads are coming back in as well. You all see these fathers. What's up, dads? You did it. Shout out to all of you all for joining us. Shout out to each one of you all for allowing us to share your story and believing in us. And we are so honored and grateful that you shared the story. Now, not only did you share the story with the storytelling coaches, but your story now is very well known. I see Brother David Carago, Anthony, Felix, Brother David, my man Al, Brother Eric Jefferson. We're waiting for some other folks to actually come in. So as we wait for David, so you all can take a breath. Y'all take a deep breath. Felix, I love your image back there. It looks like your kids, as Kendra said, it looks like they're leaning on you, man. That's what dads do. They allow our children to lean on or lean in. So we thank you all for that. So as we're waiting for them, I don't know where they are, but they should be coming in very, very soon. So Devon, and we'll bring our producer team in. I know they were in a little earlier.
Hey, can you hear me?
I can hear you. I'm waiting for David, and I'm waiting for Kevin.
I'm here. Can you hear me?
I can hear you, David. Yes, sir. I can see you. Hear you, David. David is here, Devon. We're looking for Kevin Washington. I'm seeing the fathers, but I'm not seeing David, nor am I seeing Kevin.
Brother Shields, I have my camera on. I can see you guys.
Okay.
But you can't see me.
Nope, we can't see you. I think Devon is working something out, and we're waiting for Kevin as well.
Do you want me to log out and log back in?
Let's try that, David. Yes, sir. Thank you all for your patience. Again, when you're in a virtual space, these things happen to come up. We have no control over them. But you all, listen, we want to share with you all that we do this all over the country. Of course, we can't do it now because of COVID, but the Reginald Lewis Museum is typically our home. If you are in the Maryland, David, we can see you right now. Thank you, David. And so if any of you all have a story to share, we've done stories on HBCUs. We've done stories for single moms. We've done stories for teachers. We've done stories for the LGBTQ plus community. So we've done a variety of stories. And so we're excited about this story. This is our second story, our virtual story. Our first virtual story is called My Mind is Playing Tricks on Me. Shout out to the Ghetto Boys. That's one of the first hip hop songs about mental health. And so if we got David on, we can go ahead and get started if you want to. I don't know what's happened with Kevin, but Devon, let's just go ahead and get started with David. There we go. And so we are here. Thank you, Brother David Miller, for joining us, man. We know that you are a giant in this work of fatherhood. You got a chance to hear some of the amazing stories about fathers. We want to hear from you. You're going to lead this conversation. I'm going to sort of take it back. We want to thank you all for joining us, Brother David. As Kevin comes in, he'll join you. And some people out there, if you have questions for the fathers, please just chime in and ask your questions, or if you want to give praises to the dad. But the floor right now, Brother David Miller, is in your hands.
So, man, I want to say good evening to the dads and to the other folks that are listening. Super excited to be part of this conversation, Dr. Shields. I can think of no other subject that is more important than highlighting the valuable job that Black fathers do day in and day out. And so, once again, it has been extremely powerful listening to the diversity of stories that you guys have been able to archive. And I just want to say very quickly, because I'm in a pretty noisy location, I'm just waiting for Brother Dr. Kevin Washington to come in, and I'm gonna throw him the alley-oop. These are the kinds of conversations that we are having 365 days a year, really highlighting and uplifting the fact that there is a serious fatherhood movement going on in this country. And I think the seven dads that you had tell their stories today really are a shining example of the day-to-day contributions that Black fathers are making in the lives of their families and in the lives of their communities. And I think, Dr. Shields, Dr. Washington, to the others that are listening, I think all too often when we talk about Black fathers, we talk about Black fathers from a deficit. And I think it's programs like this, opportunities like this, the work that Brother Matt Pressbury is doing with the Black Fatherhood Foundation, the work of Kenny Braswell in Atlanta, the work of Joe Jones in Baltimore, and just a whole host of people around the country that are really uplifting the banner around responsible fatherhood, you know, really helps us tell a new story about the tremendous work that fathers are doing in this country. And so I guess we'll open up for any questions or comments that folks have. And I'm just waiting for Dr. Washington to come on. I'm gonna throw him the lob because I'm actually at this Ethiopian spot in Adams Morgan fellowshipping with some folks, but I definitely wanted to chime in and shout out just the amazing work that Black Fathers are doing. And so I guess at this point, we'll take any questions or comments you guys may have. And I see our esteemed Dr. Kevin Washington. Can you hear us, Kev? I see Brother Keith Brown with his derby on. And so any questions, gentlemen? Any questions? Dr. Washington, can you hear me? And you guys bear with us. We're having some tech challenges. We're trying to get Dr. Washington queued up. Dr. Washington, can you hear us?
Yeah, I can. I don't hear you like I want to hear you, but yeah, I hear you.
Okay. Well, I was just, again, throwing you to lob so you can dunk it, just highlighting the significant work that the dads on this line are doing and the tremendous work that Black Fathers are doing. I believe that Black Fathers are the secret weapon in our community, the unsung heroes that are often not talked about. And so it's forums like this that really shed light on our role and the tremendous work that we do day to day to support our families. And so, Dr. Washington, you can go ahead and take it away.
I was just moved by the dynamics of the presentations. And so I got kicked off a few times. But the powerful part about it is understanding the importance and significance of father. And I think that oftentimes we miss the definition of the word father. Father comes from the word pater. Pater means the idea of rock, of foundation. And every narrative that was expounded upon today talked about the issue of a foundation, whether it was a father who had an anticipation of what a son would be and to become, to having to make that adjustment, or where the one adopted a child or began to assume the role and responsibility of fathering. The idea is that there was a significant role that shifts the meaning and value and worth of a child. And oftentimes, we know that fathers have some type of value, but the issue that we tend to miss is how does that particular value impact the livelihood of children? Oftentimes we think we know that we talk about the importance of mothers, but what we know is that research tells us that fathers are most instrumental in the lifelong success of children, whereas when they become adults, whereas when they're children, the mother seems to be most supportive of getting through early childhood experiences and getting through school experiences. But we know that when there's a father around, that child as an adult is most likely to complete a college, to have some higher level of degree of success on a job, and also to be able to engage in activities where there is more of a significant balance of passing on the powerful role of father. So what I experienced tonight and what I know to be true is the impact and role of fathers. And so I commend the brothers for sharing that. And also the idea of the rite of passage concept, right? Many times we know that fathers are good for sons, but we don't think about how fathers actually help shape womanhood. And so that was also brought out in this process, because in woman is man and vice versa. And so there is that sharing of knowledge, of insight, of energy that facilitates one growing up and being whole. So that is the powerful work that was shared tonight. And so I just I will pause there just so that we can have a discussion. So this was a powerful moment.
Mm-hmm.
determine how do we have a discussion? What is the discussion, the discussion point? What was the most, we talk about fatherhood and fathering and having to make an adjustment. And everyone will mention some level of adjustment. What was that part of you that was adjusted where your fatherhood was taken to the next level, where your manhood was taken to the next level because you had to assume the role of a father in a way that many of you did not anticipate assuming. So let's talk about that, because that's powerful. You are all scripture.
I'll speak for me. I think that for me that kind of happened when I found that I was learning from my son, really. As like I mentioned in the story, I went into it with a lot of expectations of what I could have my son to be. And then when that changed, I had to quickly pivot in terms of those thoughts. And they weren't things that were easy for me to let go of. And even now, I mean, I'm not sending this book off to the printers just yet. Really, his story, it hasn't been written. So I don't know what the future is going to hold for him. But what I do know is that, just from seeing him and wanting to love him in the way that he needed to be loved, and then actually protect him in the way that he would need to be protected, I just realized that I couldn't go in based on any expectations. I had to kind of shift my own focus and learn how to father him in a different way, in the way that he needed. It was sort of the whole thing about just making the right impression on him, because he was soaking up so much, and he could sense my energy. He has that sort of sensitivity. So I couldn't afford to just kind of, push him into things that he wasn't ready for. I had to kind of let him kind of show me what he was ready for. So that's kind of how the adjustment happened for me.
And the shift was this, that all of you all had to grow up. I think oftentimes we think about children, that we're here to raise children. But the question I'm really asking here is, and I thank you for sharing that, is how have your children helped to raise you?
Well, I know for me, having Keon and being his father, there was always a sense of accountability that definitely might not have been in place had I not been blessed with him as my son. Every decision that I've made since I was blessed to have him in my life, since the age when he was 3 years old, and he's just turned 25 the other day. But so that means every decision that I made for 22 years has been based on Keon, has been based on the fact that I am a father, has been based on the fact that, my wife is grown, she's an adult. And so whereby we still need each other, that Keon really, really needed me throughout every step of his life, throughout every cycle, and now more so as a man. And then watching that shift when earlier on I was a dictator, not in a negative way, but I was the one who always told him what to do and what not to do. And now that he's grown, I'm more of a facilitator and a guide to him. But the thing about it is, now he's telling me, Dad, it's going to be all right. Now he's telling me, now, Dad, you don't need to be eating that. Now he's telling me, Dad, you don't need to wear that. Now he's telling me, look, Dad, you need to reply here. Let me call this client. Let me do this. Let me do that. So it's like almost the roles being reversed, in a sense that he still is very respectful, but he's more of a protector of me now, you know, whereby, you know, it's reversed like, Dad, you got to your, you didn't call me, man. You got to your destination safely. Why you didn't call me? Dad, why didn't you hear from me? So in that sense, I'm just watching how my son has now become a protector of me. He was always a protector of his mom, always a protector. The one last thing I want to say is that's very important in terms of him raising me is that when it came to all of his events growing up, especially as he got older, he wanted his mother to be there. He wanted her to be there, but he expected me to be there. So there's a difference. He wanted her presence, but he expected mine. So he held me at a higher level of accountability.
Children raising sons. Sons raising daughters. Parents being raised by their children. Question from Mr. Edwards. Do the dads have any men in particular that they look up to as path makers and or trendsetters for their lives as fathers? That's a question from someone.
I can speak on that. I actually didn't grow up with my biological dad. So the person that I consider my dad is what, you know, traditionally we would call a stepfather, but I don't even call him that. We don't even use that terminology. You know, that's my dad. But I look up to him, you know, as the example of fatherhood, just in terms of the things that he did with me, and you know, and what he represented for our family. You know, I remember, you know, when my mom, she married him, I was 8 years old. And, you know, as I grew into an early teenager, my early teenage years, I remember him exposing me to all types of literature, you know, just in terms of really firming up my identity and who I was as a young Black man, and giving me the tools and the resources that I need to navigate, you know, navigate our society. And, you know, it's that example that I use, you know, in raising my own sons. You know, I wouldn't be who I am today, you know, had it not been for him and his leadership and his guidance, which continues, you know, even as now, you know, I'm an adult. And he continues to lead and to show that example of commitment, you know, not only to our family, but commitment to community. As you know, that's our most vital and important responsibility, is to be there to serve our communities. And he demonstrated that. That's what he preached and that's what he practiced. And so that's the same thing I want to preach and practice for my children.
You both have talked about this idea of planting seeds, that it seemed that you planted seeds into your son, and now he's giving the germination, he's giving the growth back. And also you mentioned that someone planted into you certain seeds, and so now you give that back, the growth. And so it seems like this idea of sowing, reaping and sowing is very essential to fatherhood. When you think about things that you desire to see evolve in your children's lives, what are some of the things what are some of the values that you hope to see your daughters manifest? You talked about raising daughters. See your daughters manifest as a result of having you as their father, or anyone can ask that question. But I want to start with my brother Trinidadian, who's raising the daughters. What do you want to see manifest as a result of those seeds that you're planting in their lives as women?
I think you're on mute, Baba. We can't hear you right now, Barbara.
You're still muted.
Okay, my apologies. Yeah, so my daughters are all grown. My last daughter is 30 years old, you know. They're all big women. But they all manifest in the different ways, at least one ideal. And that is a sense of a sense of independence. You know, that was something that I think both for my wife, Pat, and myself, that was kind of important, that you follow, and when I say independence, I mean you follow your origin, right? I think both of us, and the story that I said, you know, it's what it is. For both of us, it was important that we allow the children, we follow them. In a way, we follow them. That is, we see what the spirit is about, and we try to nurture that, you know? So they have their own individuality, and they can be confident in that. And that's the main ideal. And I always tell my children, I have daughters, that no man, that's the other thing, no man must take advantage of them, right? Whether it's economically, they've got to be independent, or emotionally. Right? This thing about domestic abuse and man beating woman and so on. I tell my daughters, if that happens and I am in the grave, I am coming back. But I'm coming back for them, to haunt them, to make sure that they know they do what they're supposed to do. No man is supposed to take advantage of you. Right? So those are the kinds of things that we try to cultivate in our home.
Self-respect, yeah. Self-love, dignity, yes. Anybody else?
Dr. Washington, I can answer that. Raising a daughter myself, one of the things I try to institute in her is that your self-worth is not governed by the opinions of other people. But your self-worth is how you feel about yourself. And so I try to instill in her high self-esteem, high values and morals, and also making sure that she does not live by the opinions of people, but she lives by her own facts that are in her life. So it's really instituting that high self-esteem and that high self-worth, where then they won't allow men to take advantage of them, and they won't just lay down for just anybody and let people crawl over them. They have a strong sense of who they are and who they represent.
If I can jump in for a second, it's, you know, I think what I tried to do with my daughter was like in my story, I was always saying, you know, they're watching us. They're watching what they do, what we do. So I tried to set that example with my daughter, like how I treat women, how I treat their mother, that kind of thing, so that they would see how their father treats women. And I also tried to do what I call daddy-daughter dating, where I would literally have a time where I would take my daughter out for dinner, and it would just be the two of us. We would go out, and anybody, you know, to show her what the expectations were, so that if some young man takes you out, you know how daddy's treating you. You know how daddy's treating other women. That is the expectation that you should have for yourself. And so I was trying to set an example on how this should be done.
If I could also jump in, now I don't have a daughter. I have a 3-year-old son, so we're in the very beginning stages. But one thing that I find very important in raising a young Black boy who will be a Black man is how to be emotionally connected. I think that sometimes as Black men, we have struggles in being emotionally connected and being vulnerable. It was so heartwarming to me. I think it was probably my second Father's Day. My youngest brother put a post on Facebook that shared or that told the story of how he sees me very affectionate with my son, how I hug him, how I kiss him, how I tell him how much I love him. And while I had a very present father, that was something that we didn't get. Now, that's not because he didn't love us, but it was a generational thing, I believe. It
It was not something that he himself received from his own father. And I felt it paramount to instill that, and to instill that into my child. That was one of the major things I said I must do. I must hug him, I must kiss him, I must tell him I love him, so that when he grows up, he is an emotionally connected man who is not afraid to cry if he needs to cry, who's not afraid to say he needs help if he needs help, because we have these definitions of manhood that I don't quite know where they've really, well, I think I know where they've come from, but I do believe that those are things we need to put aside, is what I'll say. We are in a new space and time. And I will also say it coming from a whole nother personal perspective as a same gender loving man who struggles in kind of in getting that in a prospective partner. I can feel it, you know, not only from kind of that disconnect with my own father, but the disconnect in that. So I'm sorry to take you to that realm, but it kind of all does tie together. I'm in a unique situation, but I wanted to throw that in.
So being emotionally available is one of the things, the challenges that you think that men may have, black men especially. Yes, sir.
May I jump in just for a moment?
Sure.
I want to correct my brother David. I want to correct him, if I may. I want to correct him on this, in the sense that there's no need to apologize. And when we talk about being emotionally connected, there was a moment right there where my dear brother and our dear brother, diligent David, felt the need to kind of pause and be a little apologetic for, you know, he's saying being in a, you know, a unique situation, or apologizing for going there. But no, we as black men need to go there and love each other and support each other and nurture each other. And we have to be unapologetic. And so that's another form of being emotionally connected. And that's what this show has done, bringing us all together.
Absolutely. You know?
And shout out to everybody, the directors, the coaches, the tech team, everybody. But this is what this is about. Tonight is another major step towards breaking down white patriarchal stereotypes of black men and white supremacy and white privilege. Tonight is a major step in that. So my brother David, I lovingly must correct you, brother, that you don't have to apologize for expressing yourself, because once again, that is another key to us being emotionally connected. And when we no longer have to apologize, then that's when I believe we will achieve ultimate love.
Absolutely, I agree. And let me say this too. I also feel the need to also say that that I have appreciated this experience, because one thing that I have seen in this experience is that each of the fathers that are here on this platform are emotionally available fathers to their sons and their daughters alike. And that is something that we don't see enough of. And coming into this, seeing that, hearing that, feeling that has been, I can't really even put into words how that has felt, just to be amongst brotherhood like this. So I just have to say publicly, thank you for just, you know, for being who you all are, because I think there are some tremendous examples here that I hope the world is seeing.
You know, there's several things happening right about now, right? So on the way, there are these various narratives, right? There's one in the Bible, right? On the way, they were healed, right? And so the idea is that once you come together and on the way, doing the work, the healing work even happens among those who don't even know that they even have some wounds. So this is coming together on the way. You know, doing the work and talking about the work is also a part of the work that strengthens us in the work. And so it's not like we have the answer. The process is unfolding as we engage in the work. So on the way, we get strengthened. So another question, despite the obstacles that you had, what can you suggest to other fathers facing similar struggles to yourself to keep going? Despite everything that you have encountered, what advice could you give to someone else to keep on keeping on. That's the new one. That's from Teresa Spites.
I'll just say we're not islands onto ourselves. There are so many resources around us that we don't even realize, just the human connections. Sometimes if you're just brave enough to open up yourself to other people, you'll find that they're going through the exact same struggle that you're going through, and just reaching to them, asking your question, being open and saying, hey, this is what I'm going through. And sometimes you'd be surprised how people will open up to you and tell you what they've done to remedy those situations. There are other fathers around you that are going through the same thing. You'd be surprised. And a lot of them can offer advice, especially older fathers who have been through what you're going through now. Just be open. There are resources all around us that can help us. Even if it's just I've discovered, you know, sometimes it's not even about them giving you a suggestion. It's about having a shoulder or an open ear that you can just talk. And sometimes half the battle of figuring out is just talking it out, you know, having an ear that's confidential, that, you know, will let you be yourself and say what you need to say. And half the time, by the time you're done explaining your story, you've already come through with a solution. So we're not islands. There are friends and there are people all around us who are there to help. We just got to open up.
I just wanted to echo that point. In my situation, I know that for me, one of the biggest things that's helped is finding that community. You know, it's once you find that community, you do realize that, you know, there are other parents and other fathers who have kids who are going through, if not the exact same thing, very similar things. And they may tell you, their child may be older than yours, so they may tell you something that can help you in preparation for what's gonna come up next. So that community is a major thing. And then also in my situation, you know, it's just love who your child is. You know, you have to love who that child is. You can't, you know, a lot of times we fall in love with those images that we have, or, you know, what we want, or we, you know, we want to brag about certain things because it makes us feel good, but we kind of downplay the other aspects of the child's personality because it may not be the kind of thing that you want to talk up when you have a conversation. But talk it all up, the good and the bad, and just love who they are. And once you start to do that, that will actually help you connect with your community, because once you say those things, then other people will say, oh, you know, my son actually does that same thing that Blake does, and so when did you notice that? And they start asking you questions, and then before you know it, the conversation is about, you know, well, what resources did you use? Or I use this resource. So you're learning and giving information. So those would be the two things that I would say that are really important and helpful, have been for me.
So to be able to share with others, have that community, to be willing to be vulnerable to someone else, to share your own narrative, and then watch how that narrative, when you share, becomes another pathway for healing for yourself. There was a quote that I heard that said that the biggest challenge in life is when reality does not meet up with fantasy, right? So we have these things that we desire, but what we actually experience is something totally different. And I think that's a part of also fatherhood is growing with the challenges of life. And so the things that we expect to happen, and then things happening slightly differently. And so when the reality is there, then we have to understand that we have to let go of fantasy and deal with what's real, what's in front of us. Nicole Stewart asked the question, what is your proudest moment being a single dad? What is your proudest moment being a single dad? That's the question.
I'd like to take that. My proudest moment or moments are knowing that I can do it by myself. Now, let me qualify that. I have an amazing village. family. My son has two godmothers, two godfathers, which are incidentally are my brothers, so his uncles. But I just was so, because when I said that I was going to adopt and people knew I was gonna do it by myself, they said, oh, are you ready for the nights, the diapers, the teething? I just kind of thought that those questions were just silly questions, because I mean, there are gonna be struggles we're all gonna have, but it didn't matter to me. I knew that was a part of the journey, that was a part of the process, and I was fully ready to do it all. Some of my best bonding moments were in the night when he was waking up, you know, where a lot of people are like, oh Lord, I'm so tired. But no, when he would wake up in the night, first, he didn't stay awake, so maybe that's why I was a little, it didn't bother me so much, but he would wake up, I would feed him, I would hug him, I would kiss him as I did all day long and put him back to bed. It just, though, bath time was amazing. I mean, every little thing, it just was he and I. But I think the biggest thing was learning that I'm enough for him and I could do it.
Anybody else, your proudest moment? You said, and I like that, David, you said that I'm enough. And I realize that there is a passage that I say is that I'm more than enough. And that if we take whatever we have in our lives, right, the persons, the people, our children, they are more than enough for us for an entire lifetime. And so you are indeed more, you are enough and more than enough, that you're capable of doing whatever it is that you have been are commissioned to do. Anyone else, your proudest moment? Okay, go ahead. There's another question that just popped up as well.
I don't know if I can pinpoint one. There's so many different moments, you know, that you go through, that you watch them. And as they're growing up, you see that curiosity about life that you know, as we go through, as you get older, you sort of forget about the curiosity of life. And then when you have children, all of a sudden you start noticing the roses because they're noticing it. You're noticing the bugs because they're noticing it. And, you know, David, you talk about, you know, a night shift. You know, that was part of the reason why I loved doing the night shift, was that the kids slept during the day. So they were up at night and I had them all to myself and we could just hang out and I could connect with my kids. So I loved doing the night shift when they woke up and they were just up and about. But going back to proudest moments, there's just, I don't know if there's any one moment I can point to. You know, my daughter graduated from high school when I dropped her off at Norfolk State or any of those things. I'm just proud of them as people for who they're becoming and who they will become and the potential that's in them. That's what I'm proud of. And yeah, it's just a series of moments.
Yeah, there's not a moment, right? There's several moments, and the next one tends to top the previous moment, right? So Devin Brown asked the question, what did you learn about yourself while going through this process? And I think I'm going to go on a limb and say that you're saying going through the process of doing the production. So what did you learn about yourself while going through this process of, I guess, storytelling? Anyone?
I can say, you know, I've always admired storytellers and people who have the ability to capture people's attention and arouse the emotion and bring points home through storytelling. And I've always wanted to be able to develop that skill. I am by no means a storyteller. But this process allowed me an opportunity just to really, you know, kind of experiment with it, right? And I learned so much through the process. But also, I think the most significant part for me was listening to the other dad stories. You know, it was just powerful just to hear, you know, just the various, like you said, the diversity of the stories, the different things the people had gone through. You know, the ways that these dads wanted to show up and represent in the lives of their sons, you know, And just, you know, and I think it was alluded to earlier, just the bonding that took place. We're all virtual. We haven't been in each other's faces during this process, but there was something that happened, you know, that was a synergy and an energy that was created as a result of everybody sharing their truths, sharing their vulnerabilities. And you know, so we became like a, you know, a virtual family over a short period of time. And so that was powerful for me going through this process.
Yeah, it was deep. It was deep because I learned how to be coachable again, because I'm a speaker and I'm a coach and I train speakers. And I tell stories all the time, but when I got with Diligent Danielle, my coach, and she was raw, real, and transparent, and I was coachable, and I became childlike in her presence, as well as being childlike in the presence of the other quintessential queens who coached us, as well as the King Mark, who directed us. And so to get this feedback from these quintessential queens, this expert feedback, and that was a dynamic in itself, because here it was, all of these brilliant Black women of excellence giving us all of this feedback. And like I said, I just became childlike, like I was, you know, kneeling before my mother, you know, telling me a bedtime story, you know, and it was amazing. It was powerful. So that was powerful to me. And then to get in a space with these brothers, to be in, because we all have men who we, and brothers who we hang out with, that we can cry with and share with, but to do that with a core of brothers who we did not know, who we did not know. Now I know Brother Anthony, but didn't know the other brothers, okay? And to be able to be emotional and to laugh and to cry from their stories and to share, and for us not to be an anomaly. Once again, it goes back to what David and others said, to be able to be emotionally connected and share. Because let's keep it real, even in the barbershop, we always say, you know, that's the, you know, that's the Black man's country club, the, you know, this, that, and the other. Yes, but even in the barbershop, we still don't go as far as we did with the Shortcut Show, where we were emotionally connected. At the end of the day, in the barbershop, we're going to talk about sports, we're going to talk about, but when you start getting too deep in the barbershop, somebody going to change the subject. But it never was that here. I mean, I was totally transparent. I felt comfortable, and that's what I learned, you know. So I thank the coaches, director, everybody, and to my brothers, man. I just love y'all and the stories that you all shared, man. And we laughed together, and we cried together, and that's Dr. Washington. That's what I got out of this. This epitomized Black manhood. You see, this is what we need to show the world, that look, this is what we do. This is who we are. We're not some, like I said, somewhere off and, oh, wow, y'all should hear these brothers. No, we have to start being the rule and not the exception.
That's it. That's it. Danielle, you want to chime in? You've been mentioned several times, given accolades. Is there anything that you want to say before we get ready to wrap this up?
This has truly been a proud mama moment for me. As Keith said, he was almost childlike when he was with us. We took these gentlemen on a journey. So we started with interviewing them to make sure they were right for the show and we understood what their stories would be. And then we sat and we, each story coach, actually listened to what their experiences were like before we then helped them to form that into a story. And forming those stories, it was really essentially, you know, it was group sessions. So we all sat around on Zoom and we listened to each other's stories and we critiqued each stories. We did different sessions with them so that they could learn about themselves. And what's really interesting, and I think a couple of the gentlemen said tonight, is really getting them to be vulnerable, which is something, at least in my experience with men, you don't see men being vulnerable voluntarily until they trust you. So really building that trust with these gentlemen. And then we actually just practiced and practiced and practiced and made sure that we got the story to where it was authentically them. But as Keith says, we just made it a little more dynamic and we were very diligent with it. So it was definitely a team effort. I think that they have formed their own fraternity here, a brotherhood amongst these gentlemen who are able to share their stories. And I'm grateful to have met all of these gentlemen as a part of this process. It's just been a wonderful process for us as we worked with them.
That's powerful. The journey, and you mentioned the idea of the fraternity, and I guess it is an organization that the initiation has taken place, and it continues as the men, as we all continue to grow in our roles as fathers, as men. And Keith, you mentioned this idea of the anomaly and the norm, and I think that we often allow the oppressive forces to define for themselves what our manhood should be. And so I think then David asked the question, where do we get the image from? If we begin to follow an oppressive identity model, we will end up in a very oppressed and confused state. And so we cannot allow, and this is what you all have presented, and you are presenting this, we cannot allow the oppressive forces to determine and dictate what the totality of what Black manhood means, right? And so to be able to define oneself as a man in the context of something perpetually dehumanizing you is a sign of resilience, a sign of strength, a sign of power. And so then when we begin to share that power with one another, it's like the human body begins to get well one cell at a time. When we share that power begins to magnify itself, and it becomes a whole new reality, not only in our lives, but in the lives of others. And so what you all have mentioned today is how you have become a power source for one another. But by sharing your story, by releasing some of that energy, you have also helped us all who have witnessed your sharing to become more powerful. And so we're not then defined by a white a norm structure about what it means to be who we are. We define ourselves in our own center. And our center means that we have our multiple levels of identity. That is, that we understand that we are not only present, the idea of being here, but our notion of manhood and identity means that we also are past and we are future. And how we understand that, because you all said that we came together, and the coming together in this moment is to understand that this is a part of every one of our journey, and that the journey in life was already dictated before we got here. And so we simply come to the space and we magnify a new reality. And so as we pour into others, pour into our children, pour into one another, we then fortify the journeys for 1,000 generations. So this moment right now, this moment that we're talking about, is one that is powerful. And I thank you all for being able and willing to share your power so that we all can be more better at being more better, because we need to get more better. All right. And so I want to bring back in Dr. Shields. He wants to wrap up and close us out, but thank you all for doing the hard work. And so I've been moved so much by being a part of the conversations in our brief time together that it makes me have more power to ascend into the dynamics of what it means to be a Black man of African descent in the space of true humanity. And so we'll talk about that on another date, about what real humanity means, right? So Dr. Shields, is back to you. Thank you all, brothers. Thank you so much.
Well, Dr. Kevin Washington, we want to thank you for being here. As I'm listening to you, Dr. Washington, I think of the great poet Sterling Brown, not the actor. When he wrote his poem, he said, "Strong men, they drag you from the homeland, they change you in coffles, they huddled you spoon fashion in filthy hatches, they sold you to give you gentleman ease. They broke you in like oxen. They scoured you. They made your women breeders. They swelled your numbers with basses. They taught you the religion they disgraced." But Sterling Brown said, "But the strong men keep a coming. They keep a coming and they keep a coming." And I think today you saw 7 strong Black men with great stories. Again, we could not do this without our great coaches. Shout out to our amazing coaches, our great directors, our set designer, our production staff, Devon and TJ and our DJ Leroy. For those of you all that want to be a part of what we're doing, you can go to theshortcutshow.com. The website is up. You can leave your information. We have some other stories that are coming to the pike. We're going to do school days one more time. But if you went to an HBCU, we want to hear your story. We have another show called Last Night, The DJ Saved My Life, where DJs are going to be telling these stories. Then we have another show called Second Chances, about giving people second chances.
people that have been incarcerated, people who come back to life. And then another show, we got stories of folks who survived the COVID-19 pandemic. But all of our shows are for people of color, people that look like these Black men. So today, brothers, we celebrate you. We thank all of you all for being patient. We thank all of you all for just sticking with us. And we apologize for any technical difficulties. But brothers, we did it, and you should be celebrating right now. Again, I am the co-producer along with my producer, Darius Wilmore, who's always in the background, but he's always in the foreground doing the work. Brother D, I love you, all of you all. We are out of here. We did it, baby. We told our stories. And as we open up in the beginning, don't believe those myths about Black men, because the Black men that I hang around, they are taking care of their children. I want to thank my children for allowing me to be their Baba. Mosiah Sekou, Samira, Nafia, Shields, Adama, and Hadaya Ayodele, I thank you, I love you, and we are out of here, family. We did it. Y'all take a bow. Take your virtual bow. Peace. Love you, brothers.
Thank you, Brother Shields. We love you, brother. Thank you, Brother Wilmore.
All right, Dad Gang.